Former Treasury Secretary Henry Paulson testified on Capitol Hill about the government's role in last year's Bank of America Merrill Lynch merger. Some members of Congress have accused Mr. Paulson of improperly threatening Bank of America's CEO to facilitate the merger. This hearing of the House Oversight and Government Reform Committee is 3.5 hours.
Today we are continuing our investigation of Bank of America's acquisition of Merrill Lynch. When we held our first hearing on this merger, I called it a shotgun wedding. Now it looks like a marriage of convenience. Ken Lewis got what he wanted, and the Treasury and the Feds got what they wanted. All of this happened against a backdrop of unchecked government power, with no transparency or accountability. Ken Lewis appears to have manipulated the accountable system to his benefit. He started this bailout in motion when he made the first phone call to Mr. Paulson. They got the government involved. He got the Treasury to cough up $20 billion of taxpayers' money to help finance his merger. He never had to disclose $12 billion in Merrill Lynch losses to investors until it was over. He never had to ask the shareholders to reconsider the transaction. In the end, Mr. Lewis got everything he wanted. Mr. Paulson and Mr. Bernanke also got what they wanted out of this marriage. They got an uninterrupted merger that they believe helped to stabilize the market. The problem is that while all of this was going on, the American people, investors, and the Congress were kept in the dark. There was no oversight to determine whether this arrangement made sense. In my view, this is unacceptable and must be prevented from happening in the future. That being said, significant issues need to be resolved today. Was Bank of America really forced to go through with the deal, or was this just an old-fashioned Brooklyn shakedown? Did Ken Lewis threaten to back out of the deal in order to squeeze more money out of the federal government? If Mr. Paulson believed that Ken Lewis had demonstrated a colossal lack of judgment, why did he and Mr. Bernanke leave Lewis in charge of Bank of America? Did government officials tell Ken Lewis to keep quiet about the escalating losses at Merrill Lynch and the government's commitment to provide billions in federal funding? Did Congress make a mistake in conferring broad authority on the Fed and Treasury in October 2008 when the TARP fund program was created? Should Congress have required more accountability, transparency, and checks and balances in the operation of the TARP funds? Perhaps Mr. Paulson will help us shed some further light on this transaction and help us to answer these questions. I look forward to his testimony this morning. I now yield 5 minutes to our ranking member of the full committee, Mr. Darrell Issa, for his opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for being a full partner in this process. Mr. Chairman, I would ask unanimous consent that the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Stearns, and the gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Garrett, be allowed to sit in on the panel pursuant to our rules and ask questions at the end of all other questioners.
I think we're just going in.
I think it's 10 o'clock. We're just going in. Okay. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, After reading former Secretary Paulson's testimony, it's clear that most of the basic facts related to this event in December of last year are no longer in question. Secretary Paulson has confirmed that he did tell Bank of America CEO Ken Lewis that if the Bank of America exercised the MAC clause and later needed assistance, then management would or could, depending on how you look at it, be fired. This is not in debate. As a matter of fact, the candor and clarity that the Secretary is bringing to us today is refreshing and helpful. The fact that the Secretary does not believe it is inappropriate, perhaps we should look at in light of the times. Just as revisionists have rewritten what we were doing after 2001 to protect the homeland, we are already beginning to question whether, in fact, means used at the disposal of the Fed and the Treasury and the FDIC were inappropriate or appropriate now that, of course, a global financial meltdown has been averted. I think, in fairness, just like in the Cold War, had the Soviets come over the Czech border, we would have had to come as we are and bring what we had. What we had at the beginning of this crisis was, in fact, a Secretary of the Treasury, relatively new on the job, a Fed chairman, relatively new on the job, all of whom were being told, here's what's happening on a daily basis, do something about it. They came to us with a plan that I voted against, a plan to buy toxic assets for some $700 billion. But when they went back and started looking at how to execute after receiving it, it became clear that it was more complex, that it was more nuanced, that the needs were not necessarily for toxic asset purchases, and that it might not be in the taxpayer's best interest. So although there will be some things that I approve of and some that I disapprove of, I think today, Mr. Chairman, we have to consider with this last witness the situation that existed at that time, one in which the President had lobbied heavily for monies, but without anyone having a book written on how you get through these times. Wall Street perhaps would say that the end justifies the means. We have, in fact, been saved. Here in Washington, we're Monday morning quarterbacks. Monday morning quarterbacks say, in fact, if we have to play again next Sunday, how do we do better? What can we learn from what happened on the gridiron on Sunday? Mr. Chairman, that's our job here today. We have to ask some serious questions and use an expert witness as part of the process. We have to ask, what would he do differently if he had it to do over again? He may or may not be able to answer it. What should we do in order to glean the causes, the events, the solutions, and in fact, what regulatory changes will be necessary or at least considered if we are to be prepared to either not have it happen again or, as the Chairman said, provide the transparency, accountability, predictability, and rule of law the next time that may have been lacking in this once-in-a-century event. So, Mr. Chairman, on a bipartisan basis, I am thrilled that we are bringing to a close this three-part hearing process because I believe it's been is helpful and will continue to be helpful, not just as oversight, but as a partner in the necessary reform. And Mr. Chairman, I might take note that just yesterday, all of the, on the House side at least, all of the commissioners for the 9/11 style financial commission that you and I worked on together were named. That's a beginning of what could be up to an 18-month process in which I believe that both of us and all the members of our committee will be working together to ensure that our reforms fit future possible challenges. I thank the Chairman and yield back.
Thank you very much, Congressman Issa from California. This hearing is being conducted jointly with the Domestic Policy Subcommittee. I now yield 5 minutes for opening statement to the chairman of that subcommittee, Congressman Kucinich from Ohio.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I don't think the question facing us today, with all due respect to my friend from California, is whether or not this is a moment for Monday morning quarterbacks. The question is whether taxpayers should have purchased the Bank of America franchise. Now, with Mr. Paulson's testimony today, it's an undisputed fact that then-Secretary Paulson told Bank of America's Ken Lewis that the government might remove him and his board of directors if Bank of America abandoned its deal to acquire Merrill Lynch. It requires a judgment call to decide if Secretary Paulson was being justifiably tough in response to Bank of America's consideration of invoking the material adverse change clause in its merger contract, an arguably unwise but lawful action, which he viewed as a potential threat to the financial system at a moment of crisis. But nothing in Secretary Paulson's testimony today justifies the government's decision to ignore evidence that Bank of America withheld information from its shareholders about mounting losses at Merrill Lynch before the crucial shareholder vote on December 5th, a potentially illegal act. I've seen no justification for the government to override recommendations of professional staff at the Fed and the president of a regional Federal Reserve Bank for greater accountability of Bank of America's top executives. Yet, sadly, that is precisely what Mr. Paulson and Mr. Bernanke did. This committee's investigation and two previous hearings have revealed that the government had concluded that Mr. Lewis's management of Bank of America was seriously deficient and possibly in legal jeopardy. Top staff at the Fed and Treasury had determined that Mr. Lewis knew about accelerating losses at Merrill Lynch before the shareholder vote to ratify the merger, but he did not provide that information to shareholders. The top lawyer at the Fed had determined that Mr. Lewis and his management team were possibly in violation of securities laws for withholding material information from shareholders. Top professional staff at the Fed had determined that Mr. Lewis and his management team had failed to do due diligence in acquiring Merrill Lynch and were not up to the task of identifying and solving the problems in which they found themselves in late 2008. Top staff at the Fed and even the president of a regional Federal Reserve Bank were pressing for a number of new requirements on Bank of America as conditions of any federal bailout in order to remedy the deficient management they perceived. If you look at the screen, appreciative staff would put that up, you will see the supporting documents our investigation has revealed. In an email from a senior advisor at the Federal Reserve to Chairman Bernanke, quote, "There are clear signs in the data we have that the deterioration at Merrill Lynch has been observably underway over the entire quarter, albeit picking up significantly around mid-November," unquote. Next slide, please. From a restricted Federal Reserve analysis of Bank of America Merrill Lynch merger, quote, "BAC management's contention that the severity of MER's losses only came to light is problematic and implies substantial deficiency in the diligence carried out in advance of and subsequent to the acquisition. These were clearly shown in Merrill Lynch's internal risk management reports that BAC reviewed during their due diligence." Next slide, please. "The potential for losses and other risk exposures cited by management, including those coming from leveraged loans and the trading in complex structured credit derivatives." Derivatives products, that's called correlation trading, should also have been reasonably well understood, particularly at BAC itself is also active in both these products. Next slide, please. From an email from the Fed's General Counsel to Chairman Bernanke, "Lewis should have been aware of the problems at Merrill Lynch earlier, because as early as mid-November and not caught by surprise. That could cause other problems for him around the disclosures Bank of America made for the shareholder vote," unquote. Next slide, please. From another email from the Fed's General Counsel to Chairman Bernanke, "A different question," quote, "a different question that doesn't seem to be the one Lewis is focused on is related to disclosure. Management may be exposed if it doesn't properly disclose information that is material to investors. His potential liability here will be whether he knew or reasonably should have known the magnitude of the Merrill Lynch losses when Bank of America made its disclosures to get the shareholder vote on a Merrill Lynch deal in early November," unquote. Next slide, please. In early December. To get the shareholder vote on the Merrill Lynch deal in early December, unquote. Next slide, please. From talking points prepared by top staff at the Federal Reserve, quote, "Bank of America should expect to be required to more intrusive review and involvement by the U.S. government in the selection of management of Bank of America, including the Board of Directors, unquote. And the final slide. From an email from Eric Rosengren, President of the Boston Federal Reserve Bank, to Chairman Bernanke, quote, going forward, I'm concerned if we too quickly move to a ring-fenced strategy, particularly if we believe that existing management is a significant source of the problem and that they do not have a good grasp of the extent of their problems and appropriate strategies to resolve them. I think it's instructive to look at the example of the Royal Bank of Scotland, the UK replaced senior management. I would not want to discard this option prematurely, unquote. In spite of the evidence and recommendations from top staff, Secretary Paulson and Chairman Bernanke bailed out the merger of Bank of America and Merrill Lynch without requiring replacement of Bank of America's top management or board of directors or imposing any meaningful new requirements on Bank of America's management. Not every national government, faced with troubled, systematically significant banks, behaved the same way. The UK dismissed top corporate management at Royal Bank of Scotland upon rescuing the company without impairing the bank's ability to operate. Even in the U.S., General Motors' top executive was pushed aside as a condition of federal support. But in the United States, the management of systemically significant banks such as Bank of America not only kept their jobs, they received billions in taxpayer dollars to help plug the holes in their balance sheets. Secretary Paulson regards the government's intervention in financial markets as successful. Certainly, TARP and the Fed's many new lending facilities aid systematically significant banks and have bought time for those banks. But the lasting contribution.
Can the gentleman summarize?
I'll summarize right now. The lasting contribution of this committee's investigation will be exposing Treasury and the Fed's failure to require meaningful accountability from systemically significant banks in exchange for federal bailout. Not a single CEO of a systemically significant bank was removed from his job by government action for a misdeed or mistake, nor has a single CEO of a systemically significant bank fully explained its role in creating the circumstance of the financial crisis. The biggest, most powerful bankers have essentially received a free ride at taxpayers' expense. In conclusion, in choosing to bail out Bank of America without also removing its top management for their failure to do due diligence and for withholding potentially material information from shareholders prior to the merger ratification vote, the government sent a signal to the management of all systemically significant banks that their mistakes and their misdeeds will be treated differently and more gently by regulators than those committed by managers of mid-sized and small-sized banks. Over the coming months and years, it will prove to be a dangerously destabilizing signal that we will deeply regret. I yield back.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, as a point of order, we, on this side at least, we have not received any of the documents that were displayed. Could we get copies of each of those that were put on the board, please?
I'd be delighted to do so, without objection. I now yield to the gentleman from Ohio again, who is a policy, of course, the ranking member of Domestic Policy Subcommittee, Mr. Jordan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me thank you, Chairman Kucinich, Ranking Member Issa, for working with me and others to get this series of hearings here in front of the committee. I would also like to thank Secretary Paulson for coming before the committee today, and I look forward to, I think we all look forward to his testimony and the few hours we get to spend here with him. The fall of 2008 was a watershed time for our economy. Our economic challenges were felt the most by the millions of Americans who lost jobs, saw savings shrink, and their credit tighten. Unfortunately, the approach taken by the federal government, I believe, is dangerous, and I think many Americans would argue has not helped. Federal bailouts and federal stimulus packages are transforming our free market economy into a political economy. The federal government now selects the winners and the losers. The current issue before this committee is merely a symptom of the ever-increasing reach of the federal government into the everyday affairs of American businesses and American families. Should anyone be surprised by the way the federal government has administered the bailout program? With the $1 trillion at their disposal, little guidance and oversight, we have seen Treasury and the Federal Reserve behave in a way that can only be described as unprecedented. The evidence is clear. The federal government has used threats, intimidation, and I believe deception to impose growing command and control over our economy. With the increasing nationalization of everything from banks to car companies, runaway federal spending and deficits, higher taxes, government takeovers of energy and potentially health care, all while the economy is deteriorating even further and more American jobs are being lost. The American people are saying enough is enough, and the American people want answers. I look forward to hearing from Mr. Paulson about his role in these dealings and would yield back the balance of my time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much for your statement. We turn now to our witness, Henry M. Paulson. Mr. Paulson served as the Secretary of the Treasury from 2006 to 2009, January 2009. He previously served as the chairman and CEO of Goldman Sachs. It is committee policy, Mr. Paulson, that we swear our witnesses in. Will you please stand and raise your right hand?
Okay. Thank you. Oh, yeah.
Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
If so,
let the record reflect that he answered in the affirmative. You may be seated. So, Mr. Paulson, you may begin.
Okay. Chairman Towns, Ranking Member Issa, and distinguished members of the committee. I served as Secretary of the Treasury from July 2006 to January 2009. During my tenure, the world experienced a financial crisis unprecedented in our lifetimes. The crisis presented a relentless series of novel challenges that required swift, innovative, and dramatic responses. Had the crisis of 2008 been left to unfold without strong federal reaction and intervention, the world of 2009 would look very different from the world we live in today. Many more Americans would be without their homes, their jobs, their businesses, their savings, their way of lives. The crisis of confidence last fall threatened to disrupt our entire financial system, not just the institutions that had high credit losses on their mortgage investments, but all financial firms, whether weak or solvent. As liquidity dried up, the continued collapse of financial institutions that provide credit and handle payments would have meant in short order that firms across industries, not just Wall Street, but every street, would have seen a massive curtailment of access to financing needed to purchase supplies and pay employees. Missed payrolls would have quickly turned into even more millions of layoffs, and this in turn would have meant an even greater retreat of consumer spending. It would have been extremely difficult to break the momentum of this downward spiral. Now that the financial system is stabilized, we can and should take the time to learn the lessons of the past. In the midst of a rapidly changing crisis, our responses were not perfect, but I am confident that they were substantially correct and that they saved this nation from great peril. This hearing is about Bank of America, and in my prepared testimony, I lay out the series of events surrounding its acquisition of Merrill Lynch. There are three issues that are appropriate to address at the outset of this hearing. First, some have opined that I and other government officials allowed concerns about systemic risk to outweigh concerns about potential harm to Bank of America and its shareholders. That simply did not happen. In my view, and the view of numerous government officials working on the matter, the interests of the nation and Bank of America were aligned with respect to the closing of the Merrill Lynch transaction. Second, some have suggested that there was something inappropriate about my conversation of December 21st with Mr. Lewis, in which I mentioned the possibility that the Federal Reserve could remove management and the board of Bank of America if the bank invoked the MAC clause. I believe it was appropriate for me to explain to Mr. Lewis that the government was supportive of Bank of America and that it felt very strongly that if Bank of America exercised the MAC clause, that would show a colossal lack of judgment and would jeopardize Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, and the financial system. It was also appropriate for me to remind him that under such circumstances, the Federal Reserve could invoke its authority to remove management and the board of Bank of America. I intended my message to reinforce the strong view that had been expressed by the Fed and which was shared by the Treasury that it would be unthinkable that Bank of America, the suggestion has been made that I discouraged Mr. Lewis from making required disclosures to the public markets about losses at Merrill Lynch. That simply did not happen, and Mr. Lewis has denied it unambiguously in testimony before this committee. I would like to conclude with what is most prominent in my recollection of the events of last fall. What I recall most vividly is a nation faced with the threat of an unparalleled economic crisis and the efforts of the men and women from both the public and private sectors who worked hard to steer our nation away from that precipice. It was my privilege to work with them, and I am proud of what we have accomplished. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'd be very happy to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Paulson. Now, we will begin with the question period. Each member in turn will have 5 minutes, of course, and I will begin. As you can see, put the document up on the screen, Mr. Lewis of Bank of America claimed under oath to Attorney General Cuomo's office that he would have renegotiated the deal if you didn't tell him he could not do so. A lawyer says to Mr. Lewis, you can always renegotiate. Mr. Lewis says, not when you're told you cannot do it. Mr. Lewis is asked, would you have tried to renegotiate the price if you weren't told not to do it by Mr. Paulson? Mr. Lewis's answer to that is yes. Is it true then, Mr. Paulson, that you told Mr. Lewis he could not renegotiate the Merrill deal?
Well, wasn't quite that direct or specific, but I can be very clear that we viewed the invocation of a MAC clause, whether it was to renegotiate or just get out of the merger, as being very risky. The markets were driven by fear and uncertainty, and an invocation of a MAC clause, whether it was ultimately going to be resolved by the courts or be resolved by a renegotiation and a shareholder vote, would lead to an extended and difficult process. And the fact still remained that we viewed the MAC clause as being a legally binding contract.
Was that a yes?
Well, that was what I said. I said that we viewed, I know the Fed viewed, that the invocation of a MAC clause would be a serious mistake. It would be a colossal lack of judgment if he invoked the MAC clause, whether it was to renegotiate or whether it was to go through the courts.
Yeah, I'm still trying to find out whether that was a yes or no.
Well,
and maybe it's not allowed.
Did I order him directly? It wasn't that direct, but I did say that I thought invoking the MAC clause would be a colossal lack of judgment. There was no sound legal basis for it. And the distinction between invoking the MAC clause to renegotiate or go to the courts was one that for all practical purposes was not a significant one.
Well, let me say, if he had issued and indicated the fact that the MAC clause, that he wouldn't that be a colossal lack of judgment on his part? And wouldn't this have jeopardized his own bank and the American economy if he exercised the MAC?
Yes. Yes, Mr. Chairman. It was the view of very experienced Federal Reserve lawyers that there wasn't a sound legal basis. And it is my understanding that there is no instance where a Delaware court has let a company use a MAC clause to get out of a merger. And this particular MAC clause even had a carve-out, which carved out changes due to market conditions.
My concern is that if you had those concerns, you know, why didn't you just fire him?
Well, I would say this. Remember, Mr. Lewis did not invoke the MAC clause. He did not do something that caused a colossal, that showed a colossal lack of judgment. Mr. Lewis was considering this, and his board was considering this, and they decided to fulfill their contract and acquire Merrill Lynch.
Yeah. Well, you know, it seemed to me that if he has this lack of judgment, I mean, how could you give him $20 billion? Seemed to me you would have just forced his hand at that point in time and pushed him out.
Mr. Chairman, I'm making a distinction between an action that he might have taken, which he didn't take. If he had taken an action that showed a lack of judgment, I think then the regulator would have been irresponsible if the regulator didn't push him out. But he did not take that action, and they fulfilled their contract and they acquired Merrill Lynch.
I'm running out of time here. Did you call Mr. Lewis or did he call you in reference to this deal?
In which of these calls?
Is it true that Mr. Lewis called you in December 2008 and asked the government to get involved in the Merrill Lynch deal, or did you call him?
No, the first time we heard of this was a call from Lewis. And so on December 17th, I heard from a member of my staff that he would be calling, and then I got a call from him, and he said that he and his board were concerned to learn of the extent of Merrill losses, which had he'd become aware of very recently.
Yeah. Well, I mean, my time has expired, but let me just ask you this before we run to the is it true that Bank of America first brought up the bailout? Did they bring up the bailout to you, or did you bring up the bailout to them?
Well, Bank of America came to us with their concerns about their losses and their concerns about going ahead with the acquisition. And in terms of the bailout, I'm not. I prefer to use the word rescue, but whatever word we use, that this came out of discussions because we had a very much, at least I think we had an alignment of interest, because my concern was the American people. And I took a look at the losses that I heard coming as
you
being
pull the mic just a little closer to you? Pull the mic a little closer to you.
Oh, I'm sorry. So as I said, the rescue came out of discussions, and I believe it was the view of the government, the Fed and Treasury, that when these announces were announced, that they would truly shake the market were it not for some form of government support being in place. And so we felt that we needed that in place in order to keep the system intact.
Yeah. Well, let me just say we'll continue to on the second round. I yield to the Congressman from California, Ranking Member Mr. Issa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Paulson, you know, with our previous two testimony witnesses, obviously Chairman Bernanke found himself in an odd situation of saying, although Mr. Cuomo had said that the threat that you had said, and I'll quote it as best I can, from his letter, Secretary Paulson has informed us that he made the threat at the request of Chairman Bernanke. Now, that came from Cuomo's office, and I apologize that his work was a little sloppy. We get a letter, but there's no transcript, there's no written record, so we have to take his interpretation of your statements, and that's one of the reasons you're here today. We also dealt with Ken Lewis, who came here with a situation in which he had received a threat by your own statements, and yet he had to say that the threat was not the reason that he went through with a bad deal, for if he had said that, then the Ohio pension funds and others that have sued saying that the merger diminished their ownership, their asset value in Bank of America, would have in fact had their lawsuit go forward much more readily. So each of you before you have been in an odd situation. You're uniquely positioned to help us. One, you've told us yes, you did issue the threat. Two, you believe that it was reasonable. And I want to put it in perspective just for a moment, perhaps for historical purposes, go back to the first Gulf War of 1990, in which Margaret Thatcher said to President George Herbert Walker Bush, "Don't go wobbly on me, George," when she felt that, that he was not prepared to pursue a war against Saddam after he invaded and brutally treated the people of Kuwait. This was not a war, but this was an emergency situation. Your threat is admitted. Your threat was because you felt that there were clearly disaster if they went, if they didn't go forward with it. After I, one more thing, I'd like to ask you to elaborate on that and how Mr. Cuomo came to give us the line he did. As I, my understand is, had the MAC clause been completely valid, had Ken Lewis renegotiated, had they agreed to a new terms or to a breakup, isn't it true that, in fact, we would have had a long period of time, well, notice, statutory notice of for stockholders, and then a stockholder vote occurred?
Yeah, there is. If there had been a renegotiation, there would have been an extended period, and there would have been a revote, is my understanding.
And isn't it that which is at the center of why you issued the threat and why Ken Lewis ultimately decided that the damage from that period, even if he got a better price or broke it, either way could be disastrous to both firms?
Well, the reason, and again, I don't, Ken Lewis didn't characterize it as a threat, and
characterize it as a threat. He managed to say that he didn't feel threatened while receiving a threat.
I prefer to characterize it as me explaining the Fed's supervisory authorities to him. But in any event, whatever we...
I like Margaret Thatcher's way of doing it myself.
However we characterize it, that the concern that I had was that the MAC clause wasn't a legally viable option. There's no precedent for it. There's no basis for it. And so, doing that would have just it would have shown a lack of judgment, and I think it would have really undermined the viability of B of A and Merrill Lynch and the financial system.
Well, the going back to Mr. Cuomo's characterization of what you had to say, if you can help us, if you will, thread the needle between these two, before my time is up, I want to ask one other question, sort of an easy one. Would you say that effectively, no matter what the reason, the viability of the MAC, you were saying the equivalent of what Margaret Thatcher said to George W. Bush, which is, stay the course, get this done, it's better to do it right now than not?
Yeah, let me go to explaining the confusion with Secretary Cuomo's office. It's really quite simple, because the Fed had invoked a privilege that kept me from recounting my conversation with Ben Bernanke to Cuomo's office. So if it hadn't been for that Fed privilege, I would have told and would have said to the Secretary, you know, to Attorney General Cuomo's office exactly what I'm saying here today. And so I think it's really quite understandable that, you know, that this discrepancy in light of the Fed privilege. And right after Attorney General Cuomo's letter came out, I made a public statement where I said that my prediction of what could happen to Lewis and the board, that was for me, those were my words, but it was based upon what I understood to be the Fed's very strong opposition to B of A renouncing the deal. Now, to your last question, I was attempting to send a very strong message to Ken Lewis in terms of how strongly the Fed and Treasury viewed this matter. And it wasn't just the words that about the Fed's supervisory powers, the other language, which I presented at that time, which, again, very strong message on the legal, you know, the lack of the MAC being a legally viable option, very strong message on it being a lack of judgment, and a very strong message on what I believed and what the Fed believed this would do to Bank America and Merrill Lynch and the financial markets.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Now you, 5 minutes to the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Kucinich.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Secretary Paulson, in your testimony, you justify telling Mr. Lewis that the government might remove Bank of America management if they terminated the deal to acquire Merrill Lynch. Excuse me. You state, quote, such an action would show a colossal lack of judgment and would jeopardize Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, and the financial system, unquote. Secretary,
yeah.
If a lack of management judgment merits decisive governmental action, what about potential violations of the law? Mr. Paulson, were you aware of concerns felt at the Fed and Treasury that Ken Lewis's management team failed to do due diligence in acquiring Merrill Lynch and possibly violated securities laws by withholding material information from his shareholders to get the vote for the merger with Merrill?
I've become aware from some of the emails that this committee has released and other documents.
Did you know at that time?
That there were concerns. And I know that there were some concerns
at that time. Did you know, Mr. Secretary,
by staff members, some concerns at that time as to whether how you know, along the lines of what you expressed on due diligence. I had not heard concerns at that time about securities laws.
Now, Chairman Bernanke testified here that he shared those concerns about Bank of America's management. Did you share the concerns with anyone?
In terms of concerns about Bank of America's management, here's what I would say about management. That, and Congressman, I have been involved and was involved in at least three situations when I was at Treasury where CEOs were replaced. Fannie, Freddie, AIG.
Let me ask you this on that point. Did in 2008, did you ever inform the management of any systemically significant bank that they would be forced out for any reason?
Well, I would say this. Here's the calculus. You have to ask yourself, is this management capable of running the firm, and is there someone else there that, or someone else you know of, that can do a better job? And I would say that these large, complex financial institutions are not easy to run, and it's not easy to find strong people to run them during a financial crisis.
Well, you know, I just want to say this, Mr. Paulson, and we have a limited time here, so I you know, appreciate you answering these questions. The investigators of this committee have reviewed tens of thousands of pages, including notes of conversations you participated in, where the federal response to Bank of America's problems was crafted. These documents clearly show that you were an advocate of aggressive fiscal response. You advocated for a large cash injection, a very large asset protection plan. But nowhere in these documents did we find evidence that you advocated for holding Bank of America's management accountable for failing to do due diligence and for withholding potentially material information from shareholders. So, Mr. Secretary, did you, in fact, advocate for requiring such accountability as a condition of the bailout you were developing?
I advocated the accountability we put in place, which was we treated Bank of America like Citigroup. We treated them differently than those that went to the TARP the first time. So we had tougher restrictions on executive comp, and we had provisions on foreclosure mitigation. But in terms of replacing the CEO. In this situation, it was my judgment, and it was a judgment of the regulator, that it was appropriate to keep Mr. Lewis. It was that this is a decision that's made by the board of directors, and for regulators to come in and decide to replace him, we didn't think that was appropriate.
Now, Mr. Paulson, as you know, invoking the MAC, however ill-considered it would have been, was not against the law. Meanwhile, Bank of America's decision to withhold material information about a merger from shareholders and their failure to do due diligence are potential violations of law. Perhaps you can explain to this committee how a Secretary of the Treasury can justify punishing an unwise but lawful act while ignoring potentially illegal ones.
Well, in terms of legality...
Could you speak closer to the mic?
Yeah, I would say in terms of legality, I think that's... I certainly don't feel qualified to sit here and opine on whether there was an illegal action. And I certainly have not seen evidence of an illegal action, and that is in terms of the relationship between B of A and the capital markets and the relationship between B of A and the SEC, I think that's a matter for others to opine on.
I now yield to the ranking member, Mr. Jordan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think as I look at this, I think when most people look at this, they see a clear pattern of deception and intimidation. I don't think there's anyone in this room who doesn't believe that you guys intimidated Mr. Lewis. I think it starts at the October 13th meeting when you called the 9 biggest banks to Washington. They didn't know what the meeting was about. The whole meeting took 45 minutes. You slide a piece of paper across. They have to sign it and write in the amount of TARP money they're going to take. And I think it continues. But my biggest concern is this. Again, what I've said is a pattern of deception, because I mean, and this is the concern. I think American people need to see this situation because it sheds light on where we're headed. We got Car Czar, Pay Czar, 21 other czars. We got Auto Task Force. We got unprecedented involvement by the government in the private sector, and coming soon to families across America. We got this comparative effectiveness board that's want to decide what kind of health care you got to get. So it's important we see what happens when you give this kind of involvement to the federal government. So I just want to walk you through a series of things that took place in this acquisition, and then ask you a question at the end. First of all, I want to start with what some people would describe as an exaggeration. You said the world was going to end, everything was going to be terrible if, in fact, this deal didn't get completed. And yet there are people at the Fed, like Mr. Ashcraft, who said the doomsday predictions were, quote, little over the top. You timed the release of information, so you kept the American public in the dark. You only gave verbal assurances to Mr. Lewis. You wouldn't put anything in writing. You didn't want that out. You made sure that Ken Lewis's testimony to Attorney General Cuomo, he said, Mr. Paulson said, we don't want a disclosable event. We have the Angiulo email, which said we want to, if Merrill decides to file early, we want to steer Merrill to a later filing debate. So you controlled when the American people could get this information, even though you're using $700 billion of their money. You deceived the regulators. We have the Attorney General's letter to Congress. And I quote, Secretary Paulson did not keep the SEC chairman in the loop during discussions and negotiations with the Bank of America. The Office of the Comptroller of the Currency was also kept in the dark. We have letters, email from Brian Peters from the New York Fed, where he's talking about an upcoming conference call. And he's, quote, given the presence of the OCC on the call, I think we should not discuss or reference the call with Ken Lewis and Secretary Paulson. Maybe most importantly, and I just want to read from our staff did good work. I want to read from the memo they put together. You kept the Financial Stability Oversight Board in the dark as well. And let me just read this. Not only did Mr. Paulson and Mr. Bernanke deliberately keep the SEC and OCC in the dark about events at Bank of America Merrill Lynch, you also failed to raise the issue at two consecutive meetings of the Financial Stability Oversight Board, which Congress established to bring oversight to TARP. According to the minutes of these FSOB meetings, it was not until the January 15th meeting that you and Mr. Bernanke informed the board of the government's plans for additional bailouts of Bank of America in connection with the Merrill Lynch merger. So again, you claim that failing to force the merger would have had catastrophic effect on financial stability, yet it wasn't worth revealing to the Financial Stability Oversight Board. So you got financial instability is going to happen, but you're not going to reveal what's going on to the Financial Stability Oversight Board. And then the last example I would point to is one I started with. Go back to the October 13th meeting. You deceived the banks involved with this. I mean, this is based on Ken Lewis's testimony. I've asked this question, talked about this both with him and with Fed Chairman Bernanke. You called the 9 biggest banks to Washington. They don't know what the meeting's about. The whole meeting takes 45 minutes. They said on one, he described the meeting. They said on one side, you, Mr. Geithner, Mr. Bernanke, Ms. Baer said on the other side, and you basically tell them they're going to take TARP money, like it or not. And so I have one question, and this, I think this is critical. That was on October 13th, that meeting. I want to go back to October 3rd, because that's when this whole thing started. When we started down this bailout road, this bailout fever that's grabbed Washington, it frankly started on October 3rd when the Congress of the United States decided to give you $700 billion of taxpayer money. And the whole premise of that action was that you were going to take that money and you were going to go buy the troubled and toxic assets. You were going to clean things up and things were going to get back on the right track. And yet, to date, the Treasury has not purchased those assets. So I want to know, when did you know that you could not be able to do what you told Congress? I remember hearing sitting in on the conference calls with you and Mr. Bernanke. I remember when you came in front of lawmakers and you talked about, we're going to buy these troubled assets. And yet, less than, or actually 10 days later, you had changed direction completely and instead just injected capital into the institution. So did you deceive Congress before the October 3rd vote, Mr. Paulson?
Yeah. Let me.
And again, pretty clear pattern of what's taking place.
Well, unfortunately, I don't think I have time to respond to every question you asked or every statement you made, many of which I disagree with. But let me get to the TARP, because I think that's critical. We went to Congress, and when we asked for authority to buy illiquid assets, we also recognized we needed flexibility. And we worked with Congress to make sure that we had the flexibility to deal with whatever we had coming at us. Congress, I believe, knew they were giving us this flexibility, and thank goodness they did give us that flexibility. Now, what happened in the last few days before we got the TARP legislation, which passed on October 3rd, and in the week after we got the TARP legislation, the markets continued to freeze up. We had a whole series of bank failures overseas. 5 or 6 different countries had to intervene to rescue their banks. Market participants were clamoring for us to do something quickly. We needed to do something quickly. And the way we were able to do something quickly and make a difference and make a dramatic difference and prevent something very dire from happening was to make the change and inject capital. And I would say one other thing. I think subsequent events have proven unequivocally that there is not an easy, quick way to purchase illiquid assets. So when did I come to the conclusion that we would we needed to move and do something? It was
Between October 3rd and October 13th,
it wasn't,
obviously.
No, it was not.
My question is, was it before October 3rd?
It wasn't. I would say.
Would you disagree? Wouldn't you say the main point that you and Mr. Bernanke sold, and I didn't go along with this, I thought it was a crazy plan. Yeah. The main point you sold to the Congress of the United States was we were going to go in and buy these toxic troubled assets.
Well, I would say this.
Would you agree? Yeah, that was the main point.
That was,
and it changed in 10 days.
Let me say this: that was the main thrust, and that's what we talked about. But we, from the beginning, wanted flexibility. Congress wanted to give us flexibility. It was very good that Congress gave us flexibility.
The gentleman's time has expired. I now yield to the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Ken Jorski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, I'm not sure that the committee here isn't having this examination to find out whether we could promote the shareholders' interest of Bank of America. That seems to be what you potentially violated. But I'm going to give you an opportunity, since this is your first testimony before the Congress, to be a little more explicit and descriptive of the situation that happened in September 15th, the 18th, and then on October 3rd by act of Congress, processes were taken so that we can return. You heard my colleagues on the other side seem to suggest that you overreacted, that there was an exaggeration of difficulty and that in some way abuse of power occurred on behalf of yourself and the President and this Congress in acting precipitously in the fall of 08 in this disaster. Now, we've had the occasion to have Chairman Bernanke before this committee and before the Financial Committee on three or four times, and I always ask the question of them to make sure we restate that picture and that the American people have a chance to understand what happened. And I dare say for criticism, I think both yourself and Chairman Bernanke and the new Secretary of Treasury have failed to inform adequately the American people as to what meltdown meant. I remember those vital days and some of those meetings and telephone conference calls that we all participated in and some of the descriptions. And I don't want to provide that testimony, but I'm hoping that maybe you may remember whether questions of law and order were asked, whether questions of the capacity to feed the American people for what period of time were asked. I'm not going to say what I remember the answer to be, but I think when you give the description now, something dire had to be stopped from happening. That's great for you to understand that and those of us that were there, but that doesn't mean a damn thing to the American people. And as we move through this, you can see committee members here don't quite understand what the situation of September, October, November, and December of 08 was like. Please take moments now to describe as fully in detail as you can what were the projections that could happen to not only the United States but the world in a period of 24 hours, 48 hours, 72 hours, and how that would comport to what life would be like if no action were taken.
Congressman, thank you for the question. And one of the issues we dealt with at the time was the more explicit we were, the more graphic we were, the more this would terrify the American people, the more it would terrify the American people and lead to an even greater economic problem. And so we were, as we were attempting to explain this, it was, there was this conflict. We didn't want to overly scare people and make it worse.
Well, now take the opportunity to scare people. Okay. Well, tell them the truth. I mean, we've got to deal with the American people now and some of our fellow members who think that this was a facade of some sort, that it didn't really happen, that we weren't in jeopardy.
If you have a situation where a banking system is frozen and money can't move between financial institutions, what ultimately happens is that every business, even businesses that seem to be solid and small businesses across America, will not be able to fund their inventory. They won't be able to meet their payroll. That you will have a when a financial system breaks down, the kinds of numbers that we were looking at in terms of unemployment was much greater than the numbers we're looking at now. People in the streets, and of course around the world, it is very significant because I remember talking with, for instance, German leaders who were explaining to me that that people in the old East were unhappy with the big discrepancies in wealth, but they at least believed in the system and believed in some form of market-driven capitalism. But that that if we had a meltdown of the system, it could lead to chaos or people even questioning the basic system, and so. Let me
put it a little more succinctly because we are running out of time. Mr. Paulson, I was in New York the other day and I had this very discussion with a lot of your former colleagues on Wall Street, and we talked about what could have happened if the President, if yourself, and if the Congress had not taken action. And the one member I remember sitting at the panel described it that he said that the people that have talked about we would have gone back to the 16th century were being optimistic.
Well, it is, I try not to use hyperbole and explain something that is, it's impossible to ever prove now that it didn't happen. But at least I believe, I had, when we had this debate, I had some people say, well, listen, look at everything that's been in place since the Great Depression. We can't have that. You know, we certainly couldn't go through that again. I looked at it the opposite. When I looked at in a world where information can flow, money can move with the speed of light electronically, looked how fast this liquidity went, looked at the ripple effect, and looked at how when a financial system fails, a whole country's economic system can fail. I believe we could have been gone back to the sorts of situations we saw in the Depression. I remember asking Ben Bernanke what he thought the world would look like, and he said, well, just take a look at what happened in the Depression. But I didn't spend a whole lot of time thinking about that because I knew it was going to be very bad, and I never wanted to experience very bad. I didn't want to ever get to the point where we could really understand it.
But the gentleman's time has long expired, yeah. So let me move to Congressman Burton from Indiana.
Mr. Paulson, there are those of us that don't agree with your analysis that going about solving this problem was the correct way. You know, if you look at the, you talk about a meltdown. We have 9.5% unemployment right now. If you take into consideration those who are working part-time or who are getting unemployment compensation, it's closer to 16.5%. There was an article in the Wall Street Journal. So you're talking about how you guys saved the economy and saved the world. We do have a meltdown going on right now, and if you don't believe it, go out to Indiana and look at some of the parts of my district. Let me just ask you a couple questions. First of all, I asked Mr. Bernanke if he talked to you about telling Mr. Lewis if they used the MAC clause that they were going to be fired. And he said he didn't give you any instruction or say anything to you about that. And yet when you spoke, you said that in your testimony, you said you were confident that that was a strong opinion of the Federal Reserve. How did you know that? I mean, there must have been some communication. How did you know, I mean, that you were confident that was their position?
I would say two things there. First of all, you're right that I do not remember Ben Bernanke ever suggesting to me that the
you
Fed...
You don't remember. Mr. Bernanke said the same thing. He said he didn't remember.
But what I do, so you ask where I came away with that view.
Yeah.
And I participated in a number of meetings and calls where Chairman Bernanke participated. There were lawyers from the Fed, staff members from the Fed, people from Treasury. And I came away from that, those calls with that understanding.
Well, if you came away from that from those phone calls, somebody must have said, hey, we can't let them do this.
Well, I just...
And I would suggest that it might have been Mr. Bernanke.
Well, what I would say to you, I do not know whether someone in those conversations or calls expressly said it, or if my understanding came from just the tone and the forcefulness.
You know, you're a very smart man. I don't think anybody's buying what you're saying right now. I mean, you guys were on a phone call. There was a number of conversations and emails, and you're saying that you didn't get any suggestion from Mr. Bernanke that that he wanted you to let them know they were going to be fired if they didn't do what you said?
I said I clearly came away with the understanding that this committee has, and which was substantiated by the emails that have been released and some of the other things, that that was the view of the Fed. But I also don't remember Ben Bernanke ever talking about that possibility with me.
It's interesting that both you and Mr. Bernanke can't remember. Let me just read something here that really concerns me. First of all, they expected a $9 billion liability. And a few days later, they found out it wasn't $9 billion, but $12 billion. And so they were very concerned that they weren't going to be able to swallow all of that. And that's why they said they wanted to change this and use the MAC provision. And you didn't want to make that public. You didn't want to make any of this public. Why not?
Well, let me say to you that that is not a fact. The only This came up in connection with Ken Lewis asking me for a letter from Treasury. And what I said to him about a letter from Treasury is I said, Ken, we do not have any kind of a specific agreement here. We haven't decided on the size of the program, the dollar amount. We haven't decided on how many assets. And so if I gave a letter, all I would be saying is what I've already said publicly, which is that B of A is systemically important and that we are committed to not having a failure. I said was just the opposite. I said if we give you a letter,
Mr. Paulson,
we will disclose
it. Mr. Paulson, please pull the mic closer to you.
Oh, sorry. If we give you a letter, we will disclose it, was what I said.
Here's what was said in testimony. Bernanke and Paulson insisted that Lewis rely solely on their verbal assurance of more support because, as Paulson told Lewis in a written pledge, quote, would be a disclosable event, and we do not want a disclosable event.
Well,
and he goes into more detail than that.
Well, let me say, Lewis has testified clearly before this committee that I never, ever suggested to him that he delay any disclosure. What I said to him was something I would expect you all would agree with, which is if we're going to issue a letter from the Treasury, I'm not going to issue a letter without disclosing that letter. And I don't see the point of a letter because we have no specific agreement. There's nothing to write down. We don't have the size of the program. We don't have the dollar amount. And we've already publicly said.
You gave him verbal assurance, but you wouldn't put it in writing.
I gave him verbal assurance of that we were committed to working to get something done.
Why didn't you want to put it in writing? I mean, there's several places where he says that you would not allow it to be put in writing. You didn't want people to know. You didn't want public disclosure. Why not?
Well, because I attempted to answer. I'll answer it one more time for you, sir. I had already
Mr.
said.
Mr. Chairman, will you ask the witness again to speak into the microphone? I can't hear.
Yeah, Mr. Paulson.
I'm sorry. I had already said publicly, as had the Fed, that we were committed to working to prevent the failure of any systemically important institution, and Bank of America was one. Now, going beyond that, we had made it clear that we were going to be working with him to develop a support program, but we didn't have a size. We didn't have the amount of assets that would be covered. We didn't know what form of equity and how much. We had nothing to definitive to say. And so I said, I don't see how a letter is going to be meaningful or helpful, but if I give you a letter, we're going to disclose it. And then that got twisted around to say I didn't want a disclosure.
I know my time's up. Let me just read one thing real quick, Mr. Chairman. Here's what he said. I was instructed that, quote, we do not want a public disclosure. That's what he said, flat out.
Well, he has testified something different before this committee.
Mr. Chairman,
his time has expired.
I have a procedural question. That Mr. Paulson clearly is moving back and forth. Is there enough slack in the mic? The mic could be pulled more to the edge.
Yeah,
of the
here
table
we go. I got it.
If you pull it back that direction, maybe one.
Thanks.
Thank you very, very much. Yeah. We haven't, Mr. Paulson, we having problems hearing you.
Yeah,
okay.
Good.
By the gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Lynch.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, I want to go back to the line of questioning suggested by Mr. Jordan of Ohio. I also sit on the Financial Services Committee. You testified at least a half a dozen times before that committee prior to the TARP vote. You did indeed, in all of your testimony, along with Mr. Bernanke, expressed the intent, the central intent of this TARP program was to buy toxic assets to get the economy moving again and to get folks lending again. And you pounded away at that central theme. And what Mr. Jordan was saying, that a matter of days went by and you changed completely the focus of that program. Now, in my opinion, you misled Congress. When you were asked by Mr. Baucus in the Financial Services Committee, he said, wouldn't it be more impactful, I'm paraphrasing, to just inject the money directly in the banks, and you did, and what was your response?
I believe I said right there that
you said that wouldn't work. You dismissed that in open committee,
right?
Which led members of Congress to believe that you weren't going to do that. Now hear me out. If you had come up here with Mr. Bernanke and said, "I got a plan. I want to take $800 billion in taxpayer money. I want to give it to my pals in the 9 biggest banks of America." How many votes do you think you would have got up here? And that's why I believe you have misled Congress. Let me ask you something else. This conversation that you had a conversation December 22nd, I believe it was, with Mr. Lewis. According to his testimony, you were on a bike ride. And he says that you spoke to him. You were on a bicycle. He was able to catch up to you.
Which date was this?
I'm sorry?
What date was this?
December 21st or 22nd. I actually have it in my notes here.
I happened to be out skiing. It would have been an interesting bike ride. But.
Well, he's saying you're on a bike. Well, whether you're on skis or on a bicycle, that's not important. Yeah. I want to know what you said. What did you say to him directly? Give me the gist of this conversation. Paraphrase it if you must, but tell me what you said to him.
Which conversation on the 21st? Because I had two conversations with him on the 21st.
Well, the one in which he says that you stated that there was a real threat or the real possibility, I won't use the word threat, that he could be removed and the board could be removed under the emergency Fed power, not by Treasury. That conversation.
Okay. This conversation was one where I said to him, number one, that the Treasury and the Fed have communicated publicly that we are committed to prevent the failure of systemically important institutions, and Bank of America definitely is one. Number one. Secondly, that we believed that the exercise of a MAC clause would show a lack of judgment, and if he did so,
this is what you said to him.
Yes, and
yeah.
if he did so, it would could destabilize both destabilize Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, and the financial system, and under those circumstances, the Federal Reserve could replace management and the board.
Did you have a conversation with Mr. Bernanke? Prior to this, that you were going to have this conversation and put it on the line like this?
I had the conversation I had with Ben Bernanke. I did have a conversation before this with Ben Bernanke. I had received a call from Ken Lewis telling me that he had been giving more thought to the situation, and he and his board were increasingly concerned and we're considering exercising the MAC clause. And I had a conversation with Ben Bernanke beforehand. But I will say to you, I had had so many conversations with Ben Bernanke, I have a trouble distinguishing one call from another. And the call I had with him was not one where we're saying, now let's get our script down. I had a conversation with Ben Bernanke, told him that I had heard from Lewis, and then afterwards, I got back to Lewis with the conversation I just gave to you.
Let me ask you, either on skis or on bicycle, was anybody with you when you made this call?
I made the call from my living room and a ski cabin in Colorado.
And there was nobody else in the room at the time?
Unless one of the kids were running through or one of the grandchildren, but. Other than that, I think I was by myself.
All right. My time has expired. I yield back.
Thank you very much. I now yield to the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Micah.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Paulson, you just spoke about some conversations with Mr. Lewis. And if I could just clarify, I guess Mr. Lewis claims that he first learned of the $12 billion financial loss at Merrill Lynch on December 14th. which was 9 days after the shareholder vote. Now, you just testified that he called you at that point and told you he was strongly considering backing out. Is that what you were referring to just a moment ago? Or was it a conversation later on December 21st when Lewis informed you that he was considering backing out because of financial losses at Merrill Lynch?
Well, we had...
There's two conversations, one earlier, which is shortly after their board meeting, when he first indicated, and a second time. Do you recall?
Yeah, there were multiple conversations. The first call was the first time I had any inkling of the problem was on December 17th. And that's when he called. And
well, he said on the 14th he called you, and that's what we have information. Well, then there's another conversation on the 21st that he was, again, very seriously moving towards getting out of the deal because of what he had learned. And he said that is when you threatened to remove him and the board of directors at Bank of America. Do you recall threatening him in one of those conversations?
Well, I don't characterize it as a threat. I clearly recall on the December 21st explaining to him that...
So you did not threaten him, either to remove him or the board of directors?
No. What I've testified here today is that that I sure explained to him that the Fed could remove management and the board of directors.
Well, you told folks that all hell would broke loose if they backed out of the deal. Is that correct?
I didn't use those words, but I sure told them it would be a very serious problem and it would create financial havoc.
But there were backup plans. Were you aware of those backup plans? Did you disclose the backup plans or ever mention that you had any alternative to Lewis?
I don't know what you're speaking of in terms of backup plans.
Well, it's my understanding that that you had information relating to a possible backup plan by British regulatory authority, and that there were backup plans if, in fact, they didn't go through with the deal. You're not aware of any backup plans?
I don't know what
that was the only option?
I don't know what we certainly had we had our TARP, and we were low on capacity in the TARP, but I don't know anything about British.
I have information here we'll put in the record. We've had recent discussions with BAC and ML management, who contend that they have the required shareholder support and are confident that a transaction will be approved with tomorrow's vote. If approval is withheld, ML will continue to have access to the various facilities and programs currently in place in the United States. Additionally, it is reasonable to expect that ML would be provided necessary support to preclude sufficient systemic disruption. Are you aware of that?
I assume people are just that you're talking about a board report where they're talking about access to Fed lines or the fact
from,
that we've got
from the Richmond Fed to the UK.
Yeah, I'm not aware of that.
You're not aware that, and you were never aware of any backup plan. The only thing, and you never threatened Lewis to remove him or his board.
You keep putting words in my mouth. I've now told you three times and told the committee repeatedly that of course I told Lewis that we would the Fed had the authority and could replace Lewis and the board.
So you did tell him that you had the authority to remove him and the board.
I told him that the Federal Reserve could replace him and the board if he pursued the course of invoking the MAC.
And again, for the record, you were not aware. You're telling this committee you're not aware of any contingency or backup plans other than your holding
Mr. Lewis and the board to the deal that you wanted to impose?
I'm saying that my plan and my preparedness was to get ready with the support package when the company announced the earnings.
Mr. Chairman, I have some information contrary to what the witness is testifying, and I'd like to ask unanimous consent that that be made part of the record.
Without objection, so ordered.
Thank you.
Right.
Yield back.
Yield to the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Quigley, Congressman Quigley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Paulson, I guess I want to put this in context of what didn't happen with Lehman. And I believe the expression you used was moral hazard, which is the notion of bailing out institutions, inviting more risk-taking. Is that a concept, is that a term you'd now not use anymore?
No, I think moral hazard is a very important concept, and I do think when we have a regulatory system that's in balance and you have the wind-down powers that the administration is requesting and hopefully Congress will pass that lets a non-bank institution fail without disrupting the system, that that it'll be that moral hazard will have more teeth in it.
So why was Lehman a moral hazard and not Bear Stearns, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, AIG?
Okay, I would actually thank you for the question. I believe quite strongly that if Tim Geithner, Ben Bernanke, and Hank Paulson had found something legal we could have done to save Lehman, we would have. And let me explain the difference. In Lehman Brothers, there was a liquidity problem and a capital problem, and we were unable to find any buyer to come in and make the acquisition on an assisted basis or an unassisted basis. And so although the Fed was able to loan against Lehman collateral and did loan to help facilitate liquidation and bankruptcy, a Fed loan would not have saved Lehman Brothers. In the case of Bear Stearns, we had a buyer, J.P. Morgan, and J.P. Morgan then the Fed was able to make a loan to assist that acquisition. Bear Stearns, there was a liquidity problem and a capital problem, and J.P. Morgan took care of the capital problem. They were able to guarantee the trading book while the merger was being voted on. AIG was a different situation because in AIG, the perception at the time was this is a liquidity problem only, because they had a number of stable, regulated insurance companies that were perceived to be well capitalized and were collateral for the loan. So we faced a situation in Lehman Brothers where we did not have, the government didn't have wind down powers, the government didn't have powers to inject capital. That came after we got the TARP, and we didn't have a buyer. And so there was no power that we could find to solve both the liquidity and the capital problem.
Did Bank of America request your assistance to purchase Lehman?
Did Bank of America?
Yes.
We went to Bank of America repeatedly, and Bank of America asked each time for more assistance, and we had the private sector ready to fill the gap, but Bank America, in my judgment, was never serious about it because each time they showed less interest, and it turns out they were interested in Merrill Lynch. We had another buyer, Barclays, that we thought was going to do the deal right up until Sunday morning.
Let me just ask one more question, given the short time frame. Most of these other groups that were saved, AIG, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, the management was replaced. Lewis wasn't replaced. Was his situation different, or did, in short, did you promise him he could keep his job if he did it this way?
These decisions for the government to come in and take the responsibility away from the board and replace the board, there's got to be a very good reason. And Fannie, Freddie, AIG, there was good reasons, but I also looked at this very pragmatically and said, these are big, difficult institutions to run. Is the current CEO, is he capable of running this institution? And then you've got to say, who else is suitable to come in and run these institutions?
And I appreciate it. My time is up. I guess you could see how that appears to be splitting hairs of who you fire and who you don't fire. And it could very easily be construed to those who are making these decisions in these financial institutions that their first course, their first thought must be that they have to listen to whatever you say. They have to play ball, or because you have such discretion, you know, those who play ball keep their jobs and those that don't get fired.
The gentleman's time has expired. Mr. Chaffetz from Utah.
Thank you, and thank you, Secretary Paulson, for being here. I appreciate it. When this country experienced Enron, there was outrage from coast to coast, people who were not informed about the material things that were happening and not happening within that company, because the shareholders were left in the dark. My concern is the lack of transparency to the shareholders and to the public at large, not only as investors, but as investors, as shareholders, if you will, as being taxpayers in this country. So the question that I have, I want to get follow up on Mr. Jordan's question a little deeper into why you did not share this information with other regulatory agencies, for instance, the SEC. Why didn't you feel compelled to share information with them?
First of all, we were working with the regulators that were involved with putting the financial assistance together. That was the effort. The responsibility, it is not a Treasury Secretary's job to get between a company and its and the SEC, for instance, looking at disclosure. That I've been around long enough to know these are critically important decisions, and that's the responsibility of a CEO working with his general counsel and with the regulator. That's not.
But you were a participant on the Financial Stability Oversight Board. I mean, one of the requirements with TARP was that the Financial Stability Oversight Board, in which you had two meetings, and you did not inform the SEC, nor did you inform the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency. Why is that?
Well, let me be, because I take exception with that. After a January 8th meeting of the Financial Stability Board, I sat down with Chairman Chris Cox and I explained to him, it was still early, we didn't have the package together, but we were working on it, and I gave him the details of to the extent we knew them at that time. So on January,
I mean, this thing was fully baked at that point. That was pretty late in the game. Let me go back to what Attorney General Andrew Cuomo said, quote, that he told Congress in his April 23rd letter that Hank Paulson, quote, informed this office that he did not keep the SEC chairman in the loop during the discussions and negotiations with the Bank of America in December 2008. Is that true or not true?
Well, what Attorney General Cuomo's office was talking about was said, the question was in December. I also explained to the Attorney General in January,
the Attorney General's statement true or not true? I'll read it to you again. Quote, informed this office that he did not keep the SEC chairman in the loop during the discussions and negotiations with the Bank of America in December 2008.
In December, I did not. That's absolutely correct.
And you feel no obligation. The one agency that is out there as an advocate for the shareholders, you didn't think that that was an important effort on your part, or didn't feel any obligation to share with the SEC or other regulatory agencies?
Again,
even the one within your own agency, the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency.
I would, again, let me say two things to make it separate, because you've blurred two things. First of all, with regard to the relationship of Bank of America to the SEC, that is something that is not my responsibility. It's not the responsibility of the Fed. That's the role of Bank of America to work with the SEC.
But with
the Financial Stability Oversight Board, because this has come up now several times,
right.
We did not begin to have this together until we brought it to the Financial Stability Board, and there was a full and thorough airing there.
Far after these deals were already cut.
These deals were not cut. These deals were not cut. That's where there's a misunderstanding. There was an understanding that we were going to work to get something done, but we had nothing specific to bring forward. And the other point I made was on January 8th, in his role as a member of the Financial Stability Oversight Board, I gave Chris Cox a briefing.
I think, Mr. Chairman, what needs to be explored further is that I wasn't here. I'm a freshman. You wouldn't have wanted me here because I would have voted against this TARP. I think it's an absolute disaster. But I got to tell you that I think this Congress, or the Congress before this, did set up this Financial Stability Oversight Board to precisely make sure there wasn't this audacity of arrogance that there would be held in just one or two person's hands, and that there would be more involvement from other agencies that are very relevant, and to exclude the one agency that is shared and that is tasked with taking care of shareholders, I think is inexcusable, and I think we need to dive into further. I see that my time's expired. Thank you, Mr. Paulson, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. I now yield 5 minutes to the gentleman from Vermont, Mr. Welch, Congressman Welch.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Paulson. Mr. Paulson, I was on that call, I think September or October, when you informed Congress, you and Mr. Bernanke, of the dire condition in the financial markets. And my understanding of what your goals were in Mr. Bernanke at that time were to do basically three things. One, stabilize the financial system. Number two, eventually reform the system. And number three, repay the taxpayer. Is that more or less a fair assessment,
yes.
Summary?
Yep.
I want to go to this, and I share that concern about repaying the taxpayer. When the deal with Bank of America went through, the federal government, and you were very much a part of this, did two things to help in a stability effort. One was the TARP payment of $20 billion, and number two was the asset backing of these mortgage-backed securities of $118 billion, correct?
Yep.
And the intention was that the taxpayer get repaid on that $20 billion TARP payment. Some firms have repaid, Goldman Sachs, J.P. Morgan. And there was going to be an 8% interest rate paid to the taxpayer on preferred stock, correct?
On the second round is 8%.
And then there was a $118 billion backing by the U.S. government in a non-recourse loan that provided assurance to the Bank of America shareholders and to the owners of these securities that the federal government would make good on them in the event that there was a collapse, correct?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And my understanding is that it was the intention of the Treasury Department that the taxpayers be compensated for providing this guarantee, correct?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And that guarantee was going to be, as I understand it, in the form of a fee of about $4 billion, correct?
Yeah, I've forgotten the precise number, but that sounds about right.
That sounds about right. And that fee would be arrived at in the ordinary course of what was the customary fee for such a guarantee program, correct?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis is now, and you understood as in your capacity as Treasury Secretary, that in fact the American taxpayer was on the hook to backstop those loans if they went sour, correct?
Well, I clearly understood that we had a term sheet and that the deal wasn't finalized yet, but we were, you know, and then I left office before it was finalized.
I understand that, but a deal's a deal, and you shake hands and that's all you need. And that's, you know, frankly, I think that's the way most Americans would be, right?
I would say on this one, I know where you're leading. I don't have the details because
I'm not asking the details.
I'm not sure why
you
it didn't.
You as the Treasury Secretary of the United States government, a person filling the shoes of Alexander Hamilton, would agree that when you give your word, you're going to keep your word.
I would expect we would keep the word, but...
And I think you would, and I give you credit for that. My question is this. Mr. Lewis apparently is now saying that there was no deal. He didn't sign it. Even though he benefited by it, he doesn't want to pay back the American taxpayer for the benefit that the Treasury and the U.S. taxpayer provided. Is that the right thing for Mr. Lewis to do?
Well, I don't know what the circumstances are. So I don't know why.
There's a lot of things you did well, and I think I understand you're trying to stabilize the situation. But this, frankly, I think is a simple yes or no. We put, we being the Treasury Department, the U.S. taxpayers, $118 billion of our money at risk. Bank of America took a great advantage of that because that provided stability and confidence. And now Mr. Lewis says he doesn't have to pay for it because somebody forgot to have the term sheet signed. Is that acceptable to you?
Can I just explain why I'm hedging on this? Because I was part of doing a similar deal for Citigroup. And we had a term sheet, and then it was very difficult to get it done. And Citigroup wanted to get it done at least as much as the U.S. government, and it was hard to get it done. So what I don't know, if the circumstance was as you presented it, okay, then there'd be one answer. But I do not know why, because I wasn't there. All I know is we had a term sheet, I left government, and the deal didn't close.
Well, I mean, here's the bottom line on that, and this is one of the frustrations. A lot of us voted for that program.
Right.
Because we felt it was a lesser of evils. We didn't want to. And I remember you on the phone call.
Yeah.
You actually were quite candid in saying the last thing in the world you wanted to do was come to the American taxpayer and ask for this bailout. But it was your honest judgment that if we didn't do it, there would be a calamity that would ripple across all of America.
Right.
So you went ahead. We did the same thing, in effect, with Bank of America. Now, Mr. Lewis wants the benefit from the taxpayer commitment, the Treasury commitment, and he doesn't want to pay. Most Americans think a deal's a deal, and they should pay.
I would say that if it was a deal, I would think he should pay. And no one was tougher than I was in trying to protect the American taxpayer. And so no one is looking at these programs more with hindsight more than I am and wanting the taxpayer to get the money back.
Well, see, this is in hindsight. I mean, this is like a deal with a wink. The taxpayer made a handshake, we're going to cover it, and Mr. Lewis kind of had a wink or had his fingers crossed.
I don't want to take the other side of your argument. I'm just simply being honest and saying I do not know why the deal didn't get done.
Well, I'm sure you can appreciate
it. The deal could not get done for three reasons. It could not get done because it was so complex people couldn't figure out how to get it done. It could not get done because he wanted out, or it could not get out done because the government wanted out. And I don't know the answer.
Okay.
Gentleman's time is expired.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Paulson.
I now yield time to the gentleman from Ohio, Congressman Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you, Mr. Paulson, for being here and your description of the environment in which you were in and your actions. You know, it's interesting. When we have hearings, we basically try to do two things in hearings. Find out what happened and find out should it have happened, why did it happen, is this the appropriate action? That's the oversight. Why it happened is a factual issue. Now, on the factual side, what we hear from you is that you say you don't deny that you told Mr. Lewis, don't renegotiate and don't back out. You disagree as to whether or not it was an actual threat for his removal being the consequences, but you told him, don't renegotiate, don't back out. And the why, you say, is because for the American people, you believe it was irresponsible, that the interest of the shareholders of the Bank of America were the interests of the nation, which the financial markets were at risk, and apparently $12 billion is not material for you to believe that a material change had occurred, and you cite your vast experience. Now, you also say that you have taken actions, that there's been removal before. You cite the actions of Fannie, Freddie, and AIG on removal. Those were so different. You had failures of organizations. You didn't have just merely a business deal. that was going forward. So they're really not comparable. I mean, I don't think you have an instance where you can provide us that's comparable where there's a threat from the Treasury Secretary for the purposes of removal of a CEO for a business transaction to go forward, unless there are other threats that you put forward that we're not yet aware of. Now, the thing about your vast experience that just really strikes me is that you really have no exact science with your vast experience. You cite the impact on the markets, your view of this deal, the impressions of how the markets might have an impression, which is not a science. There is no accounting problem from which you made your decision. There is no data point from which you made your decision. And with all the responsibilities that you had, which apparently somewhere around that time includes skiing, there was no way that you could have been up to speed on the economics, the due diligence, the specifics or the details of this deal, to the extent of someone to intervene enough to say, do not renegotiate this deal and do not back out. Now, I agree with Representative Lynch. I absolutely believe that you misled Congress. And I want to take you back to a meeting that you had with Cheney, yourself, Mr. Paulson, and Bernanke, where you came before the Republican conference to explain your $700 billion bailout deal, which I voted against. You came forward and told us that you were going to buy toxic assets, illiquid assets, and if these were not removed from the market, that we were going to have calamity, and that the crisis was those toxic assets were causing, again, the markets to have instability because the markets had the impression that these toxic assets, having no value, raised questions as to the value of the institutions. I thought it was a crock then, and I voted against it. And then you turned completely away from the toxic assets, and I believe that you were misrepresenting Congress. I don't think it was an issue of just asking for flexibility. I also voted against it because the deal was you didn't tell us who was going to get the money, you didn't tell us what the money was going to be used for, you didn't tell us how much, and the part that was crucial to me is that you didn't step forward and say, these are the changes that need to be made in our regulatory systems and the laws to make certain that this never happened again. Now, the other thing that was important to me is that I believed that we were about to participate in the largest theft in history. I come from Ohio, ground zero for the mortgage foreclosure crisis. So when you were standing in front of us asking for $700 billion of taxpayers' money to bail out what you called toxic assets for these mortgage-backed securities as a result of the mortgage foreclosure crisis and the credit default swaps, I realized that you were asking me to give taxpayers money to bail out these people who I believe were systematically defrauding my community and the people who were buying houses and refinancing their houses with overvaluations. And I had a great concern, as did my community, that the underlying collateral for these mortgage-backed securities was not there. And that's ultimately what took down the valuation of those mortgage-backed securities. So my question to you is, Mr. Paulson, in your vast amount of experience, since you were in this position in July of 2006, while the mortgage foreclosure crisis was raging throughout the country, and your description of people losing their homes was happening then, not just in 2008 when you stepped in with your TARP program, there were record foreclosures. Mortgage-backed securities were being traded with significant questions, I believe, in the market of the underlying value of the collateral. Subprime mortgage lending was spiraling. Refinances were increasing based on inflated and escalating property values. Where was your vast experience then, and what do you believe we should have done in 2006 to have stopped this?
Well, first of all, if you are making the comment that I did not see this crisis coming to the extent it came, you're absolutely right, okay? I, like many others, underestimated this then, number one. But what I did do very shortly on arriving was begin preparing for a financial crisis. I began meetings with the President's Working Group on preparations, number one, and number two. Although I would take exception with a lot of the things you said, I began working on a plan which we had announced in March, well before I went to Congress, to overhaul this outdated, inadequate regulatory system. And so we came out with that in March. came out with recommendations that we needed the authorities to wind down these non-banking institutions if they get in trouble, so they don't have to be bailed out. The only other thing I would say to you was, I am not disputing the fact that when Ben Bernanke and I came to Congress, we understood that illiquid assets, because illiquid assets were at the heart of the problem in the financial institutions. That was at the heart of the problem. That was a major cause for the losses, for the illiquidity. And so our approach was to buy those illiquid assets. That was our primary approach. And we learned, and as the situation began to crumble all around the world, and it was so clear we had to move quickly, we needed to change gears. And I made the decision that when the facts change, you need to move quickly and change. And I'm just saying, the only point I was trying to make wasn't to say we didn't come to Congress and ask for illiquid assets, but thank goodness when we came to Congress, we also asked to have some flexibility, and Congress gave us the flexibility. And the last point I would make is the people I care about are the same ones you care about, the American people, the people that are going to lose their jobs. And the tragedy is they didn't create the problem. It are the big banks that created the problem. It's a whole lot of the problem was created not by them, but they would be the one that would pay the greatest penalty if there was a collapse. That was what I was working for.
The gentleman's time has expired. I now yield 5 minutes to the gentlewoman from California, Congresswoman Speier.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If the people of America didn't create the problem, who created the problem?
If the people of America didn't create the problem?
You said the people of America didn't create the problem. So tell us who created it.
Were
the banks involved?
Well, I would say this. This problem, there's so much blame to go around, it's hardly...
Well, give us a few people,
okay.
A few institutions.
Well, you look at excesses have been building up for a very long time. And
I just want you to give me some names. I have a limited amount of time. Would we include the banks? Would we include Goldman? Would we include AIG?
Okay.
Would we include anyone who got TARP funds?
You could say financial institutions, regulators, investors, so that there was plenty of mistakes by a vast multitude.
He'd be interested in knowing that in a financial services committee yesterday, all the banks were represented, and they almost to the person indicated that they weren't responsible for this. But let me move on. Do you use email?
Do I use email? No, I don't use it personally.
You don't use it personally or professionally?
Yeah, I just don't. So I've never used it for any business communications, just never use it.
So while you were Secretary of the Treasury, you never used email?
No.
How did you communicate with people?
Telephone.
All right. Did you know Mr. Lewis before you were Secretary of the Treasury?
Yes.
For how long?
Four or five years.
Did you know him socially?
No.
But professionally, you knew him?
Professionally, I know him, yes.
Okay. When you gave B of A and Mr. Lewis $15 billion in October, he didn't want it, we were told. So why did you give it to him?
Well, that is certainly not my recollection, but let me tell you why we gave it to them.
Very briefly, because I have a second question I want to ask you.
Okay. Then very briefly, after we got the TARP authorities and when the system was on the edge and we needed to move quickly, we decided that the only way to do something that was going to be dramatic and make a difference was going to be to get capital out quickly and get it out into 9 systemically important major institutions. So we called them together, the regulators, let them know what the recommendation was for each institution. And Mr. Lewis, like the other CEOs there, very willingly agreed to take that capital because they recognized that they had as much to gain as anyone from the stability of the system.
All right, so you gave him $15 billion in October and then another $10 billion in January 9th and then $20 billion on January 20th. It's interesting that that amount of money equals about $45 billion. They paid $50 billion for Merrill Lynch. In many respects, I feel like the taxpayers bought Merrill Lynch for the Bank of America.
Well, I would say this to you. The taxpayer is benefited in two ways. First of all, I would be very optimistic that the taxpayer will get all of that money back with a profit, number one. And secondly, what the taxpayer got was an averted calamity. Because if we'd had the financial system collapse, the taxpayer would be the people that would be hurt.
All right. Let me ask you this. This press release went out from your office as Secretary of the Treasury on January 16th. And this press release talks about the package to the B of A and specifically says that the Treasury and the FDIC will provide protection against the possibility of unusually large losses on an asset pool of approximately $118 billion of loans. So this ring fence was a done deal on January 16th.
Well, when
you were Secretary of the Treasury.
We worked out the details and put out a term sheet, but this deal was not closed then. And I left Treasury.
Well, how could you possibly say this publicly if it wasn't closed then?
Well, because
it wasn't a deal. Were you giving him something or giving B of A something that they didn't actually have to agree to, but give the appearance that they had something, and then they could renege on it?
Congresswoman, I have no idea what happened after I left. So,
but how professional is it to put out a statement in a press release that something has been consummated when it hadn't been consummated?
Well, listen, we tried to...
I mean, that's kind of like
I'm getting
contracts 101.
No, I'm getting it from both angles here. People wanting me to put out letters when there's nothing to disclose. Here we had, what we did is we communicated to the market that we had a term sheet. The market knew that this deal wasn't closed yet. We were announcing a deal with the intent of closing it. And why it didn't close, you'll have to ask people that are at Treasury today.
Mr. Chairman, I certainly would hope that we would question further who was responsible at that point in time for these negotiations so we can have them come before this committee. I yield
back. Good point. Thank you very much. I now yield 5 minutes to the gentleman from Indiana, Mr. Souder.
Mr. Paulson, had Mr. Geithner signed off on that memo, the terms of the deal?
What would you say?
In other words, you were just about to transition between Treasury Secretaries. Had Mr. Geithner or the incoming administration signed off on the tentative terms?
Mr. Geithner, as you know, was the Treasury Secretary designate, and we wanted there to be a very smooth transition. And so I posted him generally on a number of matters, including that matter, but I never viewed him as a decision maker, and I certainly didn't go to him to sign off on the details of that term sheet.
I have a larger question I want to pursue off of Mr. Lewis, but I want to correct the record on some things that I think have been misstated. As somebody who voted for all three versions of TARP, took incredible political heat in the middle of a tough targeted race, I believe it was the right thing to do, and I would do it again with some additional caveats. But there has been a lot said today about the restrictions that were put on you. In fact, you came, in my opinion, not very tactfully, and told us that you wanted basically a blank sheet of paper with whatever you wanted to do. Initially, they didn't need any Republican votes. Paul Ryan and others in our caucus negotiated some 20 pages of additional things. But the bottom line is that we left there, or the Secretary of Treasury and those responsible can do whatever they think they need to do. Now, we can try to pass blame, we can try to say whatever we want, and in the future we probably need to tie it down more, but at the end of the day, our conference, after hours of internal debate, knew that given the nature of the crisis, we had signed a blank check for good or bad, that we were going into an election season, we were about to leave town, it was getting highly politicalized, things were changing. I'm not defending the decisions that you made. I'm just saying it's a little bit much for members of Congress to claim that there were all these guidelines in place because we knew full well you had an opt-out clause. Now, that said, clearly you misled us, and we probably wouldn't have had the votes even though we underneath knew that that was there because we understood it was toxic assets. We didn't believe you were going to take over and the way this was going to evolve. Had we known that, the bill would have never passed, or we'd have put tighter restrictions in. Because what I would say is there was a verbal misleading, even though if anybody read the document, it actually gave you a total blank check. Now, I would also say, I don't understand where people are saying that we weren't in a crisis. Every 48 hours for 3 months, somebody was calling me, telling me a bank was either calling their revolving loan, the mark-to-market was tightening up their assets, so the banks were having their assets drop. People who were never late in their history, people didn't know how to get their payroll dollars. Major corporations in this country were having to borrow overseas from third-world countries in order to meet their payroll, and that I don't know where it would have gone. I represent a district that is the highest unemployment in the United States, that I have either Elkhart County has been first in unemployment all the way through. But they're 57% manufacturing. They're 17.6% right now unemployment. We were headed to a lot more than we are now. I'm not necessarily happy with everything that's happening, but it could have been a lot worse. I don't know how catastrophic, but in fact, it's relatively stabilized. And I think that we can have differences of opinion of how to do it. Now, here's my concern about what I saw in the Lewis thing and where it's evolved. When you intimidated, at the very least, Mr. Lewis, into saying the government's going to do it. Somewhere in here we went from toxic assets and loans, and your stated goal to us was we didn't want the government micromanaging and directing. That was the next step, the Lewis process. Then you say when you handed it over, you thought you had a process, but then you don't really know what happened after that. Since then, we now have common stock in banks. We're telling them on bonuses. We're micromanaging. Tomorrow, we have a proposal, now that we've taken over stock in GM, to tell GM that they can't close dealerships. Now, this is the problem when government starts to take over. If you were Treasury Secretary now, where would you have started to draw the line here? You started to walk into it with Mr. Lewis when you realized that it could kind of scrambled. Would you have moved to common stock? Do you believe this has gone too far? What lessons can we learn from what we've seen here? Because right now, the government is in so deep that getting out is going to be very difficult, and we're micromanaging, and Congress is going to start to tell people what kind of tie they can buy if we're not careful.
To me, that's the right question. And one of the things that was most difficult for me is I came to the job believing totally, and I still do, in markets and free enterprise and not wanting to see government overly involved. And so I was forced to make some decisions which were very objectionable, but they were better than the alternative. And I thought the decisions we made were going to ultimately help to preserve the markets. So I think the key question is, not only how do you get into these programs, but what's the right exit strategy? What is the right exit strategy? When is the system stable? And when do we get out? And I don't think that it is appropriate for me, as a former Secretary of Treasury, 5 months out of the job, to be, and not any closer to it than I can am now, to be saying more than that, other than because I think everyone here understands that that government has been forced to do things. I think forced to do things by not only a unprecedented crisis, but forced to do things because we didn't have the tools we needed. There were not wind down authorities. There was nothing to deal with. The failure of a large non-banking institution other than the bankruptcy process. There was so, and we had a really outdated regulatory system.
It's fair to say that even under great pressure, you didn't take common stock.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got a reason.
Yeah, I did not under.
Let me, the gentleman's time has expired, and let me just do a little housekeeping here. We have 7 votes on the floor. So the committee will recess until 1:30. We'll return back at 1:30. Huh?
Now it's going to be.
Yeah, no. I've got a plane, dude. Do you know what time this will end, you think? Do you think we could talk to them?
Hi, it's Annie. So the
committee will reconvene. Let me remind the witness that he's still under oath. I yield 5 minutes at this time to Congressman Foster of Illinois.
Hi. Well, thank you, Chairman and Mr. Paulson, for your time here. Let's see, before I get into my main line of questioning, I was wondering if you could be of help in clearing up something that actually it's a public statement on the minority side website from this committee that having to do with the CPP program and its origins. And it says, it contains, among other things, the statement that yet under pressure from the House Democrats, such as Nancy Pelosi and Barney Frank, the Bush Secretary Paulson, Bush Treasury Secretary Paulson partially nationalized the U.S. banking sector despite his own misgivings about the inevitable perverse consequences to follow. And I was wondering if that is a reasonable characterization of the origins as you saw it.
No, it's categorically untrue. The facts are we went to Congress to get the TARP legislation. Our primary thrust was the purchase of illiquid assets. That was really the source of the problem, and that was our strong intent. We got additional flexibility. After the legislation, it was clear that the problem was continuing to get worse. The facts were changing. Banks were failing around the world, and there was quite a problem. We needed to move quickly to really put out the fire. And the by far the best idea, and the only way we could think of doing it, was with this program. It was not a nationalization of the banks. As a matter of fact, the program that we implemented when I was here had preferred stocks. Preferred stocks, which, you know, they don't vote. They're minority positions, and I have always said that this is something that would be abhorrent to me, nationalization, but we did some things, and a number of any kind of government intervention was not something I came to Washington to do, but it was better than the alternative. But we switched gears, and fortunately, Congress gave us the flexibility to do what we needed to do, which was to prevent the American people from really having a very serious problem.
Yes. Well, thank you for clearing that up. And I also voted for the TARP authority, recognized at the time that this was a very important feature of it, that if things continued to get worse, that the only thing you could do fast was a rapid capital injection, and that this was an important element of it. And so thank you for clearing that up. Now, I'm interested in exploring the principle that you seem to be bringing forth in terms of that in times of systemic risk, that there are conditions under which the shareholders of a systemically important firm might be expected to take a bullet, so to speak, for the good of the overall financial system on the grounds that the firm, like everyone else, has much to lose if the financial system collapses. And that moreover, that threats from federal regulators are appropriate means of encouraging them to take that bullet. And is this a reasonable, though a little bit perhaps stilted characterization of your position on this?
That is not my characterization at all, because we were very fortunate in this situation to have an alignment of interests here. Because I have no doubt what was in the best interest of the public, which was to not have Bank America collapse, not have Merrill Lynch collapse,
right.
Not have the financial
right.
system. I happen to believe, and I think Ken Lewis testified, he believes that was also in alignment of interest with Bank America and Merrill Lynch. I believe that if Bank of America had invoked a MAC, tried to evoke a MAC, which was a legally binding contract, that was not legally valid. I think the merger contract
But still, you asked them to not pursue, they certainly had the legal right to try to invoke it.
Right.
And you had used what, what could be, I guess, characterized as at least an indirect threat to encourage them not to attempt to exercise their legal rights. And I was wondering if you see that there is need for additional legal clarity in this area.
Well, I could say I think the more legal clarity we have, the better on everything. But on this, I just want to come back to the MAC, because I've heard people discuss this a lot. No one has ever dealt with, as far as I've heard, on the other side, the basic issue. Show me a Delaware court that after shareholders have voted, has let a company get out of a merger by invoking a MAC. And this MAC actually had a carve-out for changing in market conditions.
Yeah, but your argument was that it was unlikely, not impossible, and certainly this were these were circumstances like Delaware courts have not seen in the recent past. And so are there specific issues of legal clarity? You know, for example, some sort of safe harbor for CEOs that act in ways that, that might be construed under normal times as being against their shareholders' interest, but because this is a time of systemic risk and they have been given direct orders by the regulator, it's trying to avert systemic risk? Do you see any merit in that kind of
That is something that I have. It's a very complicated issue, and it's one that I really don't feel qualified to have thought through all the arguments on this, but it is certainly one I think that bears consideration.
Okay. Well, thank you. I yield back.
Gentlemen, Mr. McHenry.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Secretary Paulson, thank you for your service to your country. This hearing is about the actions that took place in regard to one deal that we actually have a good bit of disclosure on because the New York Attorney General's, in essence, public testimony about what occurred with that. The reason why we're having these hearings is about the ramifications for the financial industry going forward. We want to make sure that government officials are really in keeping with what is appropriate. And so that's why this hearing is occurring today. Now, you've had a long history in the financial marketplace as chairman of Goldman Sachs. And, you know, a couple of these great quotes about your service and your actions on Wall Street. You know, one quote that I think says a lot is a Jim Citrin column from September last year. He says, describing you as direct, intense, powerful, serious, competitive, can-do, and frankly, ballsy. One of his former Goldman executive committee members said, quote, Hank hasn't changed at all since he was at Goldman, literally. There's no question by financial analysts or reporters or this committee members about your capacity to finish a deal. And I don't think the President had any concerns about that when he offered you the job. And, you know, another Fortune magazine described you as back in 2003 as the investment community's steeliest, stealthiest power brokers. I mean, we get the deal. You have the capacity to get a deal done. Now, as chairman of the Federal Reserve, Ben Bernanke had a different set of powers than you had as Treasury Secretary. Is that true?
Oh, absolutely.
So as Secretary of the Treasury, did you have the statutory authority to fire, actually, Mr. Schock, if you'll, thanks. You don't make much of a window, Aaron. But as Treasury Secretary, did you have the statutory authority to fire the Board of Directors of Bank of America?
No.
Okay. No. So in your testimony, you say that I mentioned the possibility that the Federal Reserve could remove management and the board of Bank of America if the bank invoked the MAC clause. So in essence, you were carrying a message from the Federal Reserve. Is that a good way to characterize this?
Well, I would prefer to characterize it the way I had characterized it earlier. I had a comprehensive conversation with Ken Lewis in which I reaffirmed the support that he was going to receive from the government because we were committed to every systemically important institution.
And that support is also Fed, Treasury, whole regulatory.
It's combined.
Game.
And so we were, and I expressed the view, and I expressed it in strong language, that the MAC was not a legally valid option in the judgment of the Federal Reserve lawyers. And that expressed a judgment that if he were to go ahead and do something like this and endanger his company, Merrill Lynch and the system, it would be a lack of judgment. And then I explained to him, that the Federal Reserve had the authority to replace management and the board. That's a supervisory authority.
And that last phrase that you said there, that you relayed the Fed's authority to replace the board, had you had discussions with the Fed and your staff had discussions with the Fed that was within their capacity?
Well, what I have said earlier, and I will repeat it, that I have no recollection of Ben Bernanke having ever talked with me directly about that authority. I participated on a number of calls and meetings where there were staff together, and I don't remember whether I heard someone expressly say that or whether it was just the tone and the forcefulness of that discussion. But I clearly had that understanding, and I think that understanding has been borne out by the emails the committee has released and sure. Some other things.
When Mr. Issa asked you in the second set of questions here about this, you said, we explained the Fed's statutory authority.
Right.
Now, did your lawyers say this, or was it the Fed lawyers that said that? Is that hard to recall?
As I said to you, I had that understanding. As you can imagine, when I'm participating in as many discussions and calls, it's different. And what I've told you is I don't remember whether someone expressly mentioned that to me in so many words or whether it just was a logical conclusion. Because if you had heard the discussions that I'd heard, where if you're running a regulated bank and your regulator says, we don't think this is legally valid, we think if you do this, you're going to cause great harm to your company and to the financial system, it'll be a lack of judgment. And then if someone goes ahead and does that, it's a pretty logical conclusion that maybe even the regulator would be irresponsible if they didn't hold them accountable.
My time is short, and just one final. Oh, my time has expired. Well, I've got additional questions. I hope that we'll have an additional round, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Letting the gentleman finish his line of inquiry. Thank you, Mr. Issa. Mr. Cummings.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Mr. Paulson, thank you very much for your testimony. Mr. Paulson, I think that you would agree with me that I'm going back to some questions Mr. Kandrowski asked you. You would agree with me, even with those emergency circumstances that you found yourself in, there's no reason to suspend ethical behavior, is there? I didn't hear you. I'm sorry.
No, absolutely not.
All right. And it is interesting that as I read your testimony, and I read it several times, that you have expressed tremendous concern about our constituents and the people of America who are suffering greatly. And I was just wondering, were you aware of the Merrill Lynch $3+ billion worth of bonuses they were about to give out when this deal came down?
No, I wasn't.
And when did you find out about $3+ billion in bonuses that the American people basically ended up paying?
I have my best memory of this was sometime around the middle of January, the day or so before we were putting this deal together, and when we were talking about the compensation restrictions for B of A, and I'm not entirely certain, but I have a memory that someone on my staff said, and in terms of Merrill Lynch, their bonuses have already been paid.
Do you think that was fair to the American people, to stockholders? And I mean, basically what ended up is that the American people pretty much ended up paying Merrill Lynch's $3 billion plus bonuses that were apparently given out just before this deal went through. You understand that, right?
Well, I do understand the bonuses were paid before the deal went through.
Do you think that's fair? And do you think that's ethical?
In terms of, those are two different words.
Well, why don't we start with ethical first?
Okay. In terms of ethical, I'm not sure I would call that unethical, that that Merrill Lynch paid out bonuses before the deal went through. Now, whether that is something that should have been done is another question.
Do you think it should have been done?
I wasn't there. I didn't make the decision. I don't think I should be judging that today.
Well, you judged everything else. You made a judgment with regard to Mr. Lewis. You made a judgment when you said that you felt that it would be a colossal lack of judgment for him to push the mat. You made judgments all along where you made decisions affecting the American economy. So why suddenly you wash your hands of this? You've been bragging up there this morning all this time about the judgments you have made.
Yes, but I do not have all the facts on this situation.
Let me ask you this. I'd like to clarify something that you testified to this morning. A letter we received from Mr. Bernanke and handwritten notes we received under subpoena indicate that it was Mr. Lewis who first brought up the issue of receiving a bailout. Isn't it true that it was Bank of America who first brought up the bailout?
I'm not sure exactly how it came up, but it very well could have been. I sure know that it was with 100% certainty, it was Bank America that came to us, said they've got the losses, and said they have a major problem, and we're considering triggering the MAC clause.
All right. So in December of 2008, did you promise Mr. Lewis that you would provide Bank of America with enough capital to fill the $12 billion, quote, hole, unquote, created? Let me finish. Let me answer. I want you to answer the whole question. Created by the losses at Merrill Lynch, or would it be fair to say that you at least intimated to Mr. Lewis that he could count on an amount equal to Merrill's losses in December?
We weren't as specific in terms of the amount and the losses. But we more than intimated. We were both Ben Bernanke and I were very clear that we were committed to working with him to come up with a support program that we thought would work.
Let's talk about Goldman Sachs for a moment. Immediately before becoming Secretary of Treasury, you were the chairman and CEO of Goldman Sachs, were you not?
Absolutely.
And as Treasury Secretary, you asked then Goldman board member Ed Liddy to take over as head of AIG, is that correct?
Yes.
Goldman has subsequently been revealed to be the largest recipient of AIG's counterparty payments, benefiting to the tune of more than $13 billion after AIG was bailed out. I note that the firm repeatedly claimed that its exposure to AIG was fully hedged and it was not material to the firm. Just this week, Goldman posted a record $3.44 billion in quarterly profits and plans to give out billions of dollars worth of bonuses to the tune of $600,000 on the average of 28,000 employees. I just ask you one question, and this is my last question. The people in my district who are losing their homes, their insurance, the ones you talked about in your statement, their homes, their insurance, everything they've got, some of them elderly going about to work, you know what they asked me? They say, Cummings, that money that those folks are getting on Wall Street, those millions and billions, is that our money? Because our money went somewhere. We don't know where it went, but we know people are getting millions and billions of dollars. What about us? What about us who are out of work? What about us who can't send our kids to college in September after they've done everything they're supposed to do to prepare for college? What about us who don't have a house? What about us? You keep telling us that the storm is going to be over, but when the storm's over, who's going to be living in my house? What about them? And I'm asking, they're asking the question, is some of this money their money?
Mr. Cummings, I want to
say, I just want to be able to answer them when I go home tonight.
I want to say two things. First of all, I want you to know that I had no role whatsoever in any of the Fed's decisions regarding payments to any of AIG's creditors or counterparties, number one. Secondly, what I would say to you is the thing that bothers you bothers me, because the people that are paying the price had nothing to do with the problem. But the sad truth is that if these companies had gone down, they'd be paying a bigger price. There would be more foreclosures. There would be more people that are unemployed. And so You are absolutely right in asking the question. You should keep asking the question. This is a terrible thing. And that's why I believe you and the other members of Congress need to work so hard to put in the kinds of regulatory reforms and the kinds of powers that we need to have in place to make sure we don't have to go through something like this again.
I see my time is up. Thank you, Madam Chair.
I thank the gentleman. Congressman Bilbrey.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Secretary, I'm sort of sitting here listening to this testimony and all at once realizing, as we're in the micro, there's a macro message here. You did say the Fed has the authority to hire and fire the Board of Directors.
Well, what I said is I have an understanding that under unusual circumstances, if the Federal Reserve is dealing with a regulated entity and that there are decisions made at that regulated entity that endangers the safety and soundness of that institution, then the Fed has the authority to hold them accountable. Now, clearly, in terms of corporate governance 101, we have a, you know, we know how boards are selected, and we know that boards select management. But there needs to be something for regulated entities where the regulator can protect the safety and soundness.
Well, I'm sensing we've moved in beyond where we've historically been. We've gone into a brave new world where now, with a de facto nationalization of the industry, we're sitting here as a committee considering items that in 1927, when this committee was founded, never dreamed that Washington would be determining what kind of decisions are made in either Wall Street or Main Street. Now Washington is making those determinations. And this brave new world we've ventured into of nationalizing, you know, major industries really does place a strain on a system that was never designed to make or to make the decision or to do the oversight, as we're trying to do today. Never was perceived by the founders of this committee that we would be having this discussion. My question to you, as the Secretary, as we talk about other situations and talk about exit strategies, where is the exit strategy? What date can I tell my constituents that we will not have this discussion anymore? We will, that this committee and Congress will not be discussing how we have influenced or directed the decisions in at least this major industry. When will we be out of the business of doing banking?
Well, I would say, first of all, that is the major question. It's a question I ask myself, and it's a question that's easier to ask than it is to answer. But it's a question you should be asking, because we, as a nation, needed to do some things that many of us found abhorrent. They just were better than the alternative. And so once the system is stabilized and the economy is turned, then there needs to be great consideration given to how we exit this and in how we put in place those reforms to really reduce the risk that we're ever going to be back here again doing these sorts of things. But I can't stand here and tell you today that I have the answer to your question, but I hope it's soon.
Well, let me just say, I think the last administration had the public turn on them because they did not have an exit strategy for another situation. Regardless of who's in the making of this, if this administration doesn't develop an exit strategy, give some timelines that do not exist today, I think all of us are going to be held responsible for the fact that Washington has stepped into something, has started punching in this tar baby, and now has no way of extricating ourselves out of it. And we have now created a whole new environment of what is appropriate for the federal government to be doing. And we're down now having this hearing about who gets hired or fired, who is notified that if they don't do certain actions, there's going to be termination. All of these things have never been perceived as being the appropriate position for the federal government, which is now the federal government's engaged into. So extracting ourselves out of the situation is going to be something I think the American people are going to demand very soon. Madam Chair, at this time, I'd like to yield to the gentleman from the Carolinas, if I remember right.
Without objection.
Thank my colleague from whatever that state is in the West. that's financially sound. So, Secretary Paulson, just in continuation with my line of questioning before, from the notes we have on your schedule from December 19th, mid-December, December 19th is what we have, it shows you had roughly 5 phone calls with Dr. Bernanke, with Chairman Bernanke that day. Was that fairly typical in those very busy days of multiple communications, one-on-one and at the staff level?
Yeah, we had, I'm not sure 5 every day, but we had multiple conversations for 7 or 8 months there.
And when you communicated with Chairman Bernanke, did you express, on this day we have multiple calls with Chairman Bernanke, a couple calls to Ken Lewis, Thane, Geithner, a number of different folks throughout the day. Did you describe to Chairman Bernanke your conversation you had with Ken Lewis?
A conversation with who?
Ken Lewis.
Oh, with Lewis. And my conversation on which day, the 19th?
Well, whatever day it was. I mean, did you describe the conversations you had with Ken Lewis?
Oh, the conversation I had with Ken Lewis on the 21st.
You talked to Ken Lewis multiple times in December.
Oh, yes.
There are multiple conversations where he said they were considering Mac. You said it was bad. You then came back and said, you know, yeah. Your microphone, I think, is off. And
can you hear me now? Communicated frequently with summarized conversations.
Sure. And at the same time, did you keep your successor, Mr. Geithner, informed?
Yes, in a different way. Chairman Bernanke was a major decision maker. During this period, once Tim Geithner was a Secretary of Treasury designate, then we wanted a very smooth transition, so I kept him posted on a variety of things, but I wasn't looking to him as a decision maker when I posted him.
Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. Congressman Connolly.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, and welcome, Secretary Paulson. Thank you for your patience today, given our schedule. I'd like to go back just a little bit, and maybe I could start following up on my colleague's question about the MAC. It's our understanding that not once but twice, Mr. Lewis threatened to invoke the MAC because they had discovered a $12 billion problem in the Merrill Lynch deal. Is that correct?
Well, what I remembered was 18 billion pre-tax at one time, and then 22 billion pre-tax at the end, and 15 billion after tax. But my numbers might be wrong.
Okay. But in both cases, they threatened or discussed with you the possibility of invoking the MAC. Is that correct?
Yes.
And your reaction, obviously negative in both instances. Why?
It was based upon the view of very experienced lawyers, and again, I haven't heard this refuted elsewhere with any degree of vehemence, that there was a legally binding contract and that the MAC clause would not have been legally valid in this situation. The shareholders had voted, and for and both companies, this was a Delaware company.
But that's really a legal matter, obviously not normally involving the Secretary of Treasury. Why would you care one way or the other whether he was acting on misinformation, legal misinformation, and threatening to invoke the MAC?
I normally wouldn't care. But this is, but if you have a situation where a company in doing something like this in a period of uncertainty and fear could do grave damage in the opinion of their regulator to that company and to the whole system, I sure better care.
You were worried about the impact on a very fragile system at that time.
Yeah, I was worried about the impact on the very practical system and also the impact on B of A, which was the biggest bank.
Given that concern, Mr. Secretary, at any time in that period in around December of 2008, did you have any conversation that could be construed explicitly or impliedly as promising
in exchange for their backing off the MAC threat or even going public with the $12 billion or whatever the ultimate number was, in exchange for that silence or that proceeding forward, that there would be TARP funding available to Mr. Lewis and BOA?
We definitely had conversations, but it wasn't in exchange for. No matter what they did, you know, I felt a responsibility. I know Ben Bernanke felt the responsibility to keep the financial system from collapsing. So this was not a situation where, gee, we'll do this big favor for you. This was a situation where we were doing this for the American people.
Right.
And it just so happened that that there was an alignment of interest because B of A failure wouldn't have been good for the B of A shareholders either.
And this alignment of interest, as you know, and you've heard ad nauseum here today, Mr. Lewis construed as almost a threat by you and perhaps by Mr. Bernanke, that if you didn't take the federal money, we were going to fire you and your board. That's a far cry from how you characterize it as sort of a confluence of interest.
Well, no, I didn't. There's two different things, okay? The confluence of interest was just what I said, which was we certainly didn't want B of A to be unstable. In terms of my communication with him, I've been pretty direct. I wouldn't use the word threat, but I've said what I said, and I was very direct, and I intended to give a very direct, strong, clear message, and that was. I'm not characterizing it as a threat because, and Lewis didn't characterize it as a threat, but I did explain the Fed's powers. But that was in terms of the confluence of interest, to me, that's just an obvious thing. If you follow the train of logic we've laid out here, you know, you either accept the logic or you don't. I mean, some people will say, well, there was no crisis, nothing would have happened to B of A, nothing would have happened to Merrill Lynch, nothing would happen to the financial system. I can't satisfy those people.
Yes. And I'm with you, Mr. Secretary. There was a crisis, and I understand where you and the Federal Reserve Chairman were coming from, but I guess we're trying to understand, and I see my time is up, Madam Chairman. I hope I have the opportunity to return to some specific questions regarding the terms, conditions of the agreement to go forward with TARP funding. Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. Mr. Schock.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Following up on Mr. McHenry's questions about Tim Geithner's involvement in this, you stated that you kept him, once he was nominated, you kept him informed. However, we have notes from Joe Price, who is the Chief Financial Officer for Bank of America, basically chronicling the conversation that you had with Chairman Lewis and yourself. And in those documents, he says, quote, fire BOD if you do it, irresponsible for country, board of directors. Tim G agrees. In those conversations, did you ever invoke Tim Geithner's name or suggest in any ways that he was on board with your view on this to apply additional pressure to Mr. Lewis or Bank of America?
I tell you, I've sure got no memory. I've sure got no memory of that. Just none whatsoever.
You don't remember mentioning Tim Geithner in the conversation with Mr. Lewis?
I don't remember it. Those are, you know, those are Joe Price's notes, and someone would have to ask him. I don't even remember talking to Joe Price. I remember talking with Ken Lewis. And as I said, I posted Geithner. I didn't look at him as a decision maker, and I just don't have memory of in that kind of detail.
So you would never have you never used him to your recollection as additional pressure that he was on board.
Yeah, I don't. I sure don't recall that.
Okay, there seems to be a lot of confusion, or it seems we're arguing over semantics over whether or not you threatened Mr. Lewis or Bank of America. And I don't think it's necessary that we argue over the semantics of a threat. I think you've been very clear, at least in your earlier testimony, that if they went forward with invoking the MAC, that you would have moved forward with attempting to remove him from his position?
Well, I wouldn't have moved forward. I did not have the authority to do that. What I said to him was, I said to him, if he did something so irresponsible, I believe the Fed could do that as his regulator.
And you further clarified that you felt that would be irresponsible, invoking the MAC.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Very clear.
Okay, that is clear. Okay, so what, maybe threat isn't the correct word. Maybe he felt pressure. Is that a fair term?
I'd rather just tell you what I said and let you characterize it.
Okay, fair enough. I would like you to respond then to Mr. Bernanke's testimony. Chairman Issa or Ranking Member Issa asked him if there were threats, which I know we don't like that term, or if people felt threatened to go through with the deals, it's okay because it worked out. Do you agree with that? Bernanke responded, no, sir. In other words, it would not be appropriate for Ken Lewis and Bank of America to feel pressured. Given Bernanke's acknowledgement at our last hearing that threatening to fire Bank of America's management to get them to go through with the merger would have been inappropriate, are you prepared then to take responsibility for issuing such an inappropriate statement?
I'll tell you, I certainly take responsibility for what I said. And what I said, I think it logically followed from, I laid out a train of events. And I think it logically followed that's what a regulator should do. I would say I think Chairman Bernanke, when he testified here last month, I think he acknowledged that if someone made a decision that harmed their company, they deserve to be held accountable. And that's certainly what I was trying to communicate to Ken Lewis.
You stated earlier that you took issue with Bank of America's reason for invoking the MAC. Did you ever personally read their legal justification?
Nope.
And you stated that you relied on the legal basis, the Fed's legal staff for their view on the MAC as your justification. Are you aware, do you know the names of the legal staff that you relied on?
I listened in and participated in a number of calls where I heard the legal staff, and I do know some of the people, yes.
Do you know if any of that legal staff had background or experience in mergers and acquisitions?
I know they were experienced lawyers. I do not know their specific experience.
Well, come on now. There's a difference between being an experienced lawyer and an experienced lawyer in mergers and acquisitions that would know whether or not a company has the legal basis to invoke the MAC clause.
I'll tell you one other thing, okay? One other test. I've participated in deals and in markets for 32 years, and when I hear a lawyer say to a company, what's your legal justification after two shareholder votes and with a MAC that's structured this way, and I'm not getting very much back on the other side, and I'll tell you something, as someone who's been around in the markets, everything that I heard squared with my instincts and judgments.
Were you aware that Bank of America had successfully invoked the MAC less than a year earlier on the Sallie Mae deal?
Was it after shareholder votes in a Delaware company?
Well, I guess what I'm trying to understand is if they legally had justification and legal expertise to invoke the MAC clause once, I would question why they would come forward and justify that they could do it in this instance and be wrong.
I've told you how I made my judgment, and that's how I made the judgment, and I think it was the right judgment.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Gentlewoman from Ohio.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, some contend the timing of what you call in your testimony a financial crisis unprecedented in our lifetime was actually a calculated Wall Street scenario underpinned with masterful deceit and extraordinary moral hazard. Your clarion call for the taxpayer bailout of Wall Street's excess
came 6 weeks before a major national election when our government is the most vulnerable and tender, and Congress skittish. What your orchestration yielded was an unprecedented dumping of private sector losses on the U.S. taxpayer. History will show that the U.S. government and you knew about Wall Street's growing losses long before the Bank of America Merrill merger. In fact, Bank of America's purchase of Countrywide in January of 2008 was but another positioning of private sector interests in preparation for what I call the greatest Hail Mary pass of all time, in taking those Wall Street losses and placing them on the next three generations. What interests me is who you helped and who you didn't. Yesterday's New York Times reports that Goldman Sachs, the firm at which you spent your life, posted the largest quarterly profit in its 140-year history, $3.4 billion. Each Goldman employee reportedly could earn $770,000 this year. And the same paper's lead editorial yesterday states, across our nation, unemployment is rising, foreclosures are surging, lending is still constrained. I wish I had an hour to talk to you about that. It looks like some very rich people are profiting handsomely. And I can tell you that those profits at Goldman, they'd resolve about one quarter of the housing situation in Ohio that we face today. Since appointment by President Bush as Secretary of Treasury in 2006 until today, have you or any of your family had any financial ties or investments related to Goldman Sachs in any way whatsoever?
No.
Thank you. What about Bank of America?
Not that I know of.
President Bush was not the first president you served. Who was the first president you served?
Richard Nixon.
Richard Nixon. And who did you report to in the White House in those days? Who was the head of your staff?
I reported first to Lou Engman and then to John Ehrlichman.
Thank you. Let me ask you about the deals you structured while at Treasury. In terms of the warrants that you structured in the $10 billion Goldman Sachs deal, the term sheet provides that once Goldman redeemed the preferred shares, it has the option to purchase back the warrants at a fair market value at a timing of its discretion. Why did you draft a provision that allowed Goldman Sachs, the borrower, to determine when the taxpayers must sell their warrants?
In terms of how a specific warrant deal was structured, I'm sure that the deal that was structured for Goldman was the same as for all the other warrants.
But why would you leave the taxpayer, who in this instance is the creditor, why would you let the borrower set the terms?
I would say this, Madam Congresswoman, those warrants are going to be very profitable for the taxpayer.
Yes, they're going to be very profitable, sir, but if Goldman can set the terms on when they can be redeemed, we're not going to get back what we deserve to get back for the American people.
There's a process, and it's not a process where Goldman Sachs sets the terms.
Well, that's
not a process where any bank sets the terms.
The term sheet provides that at a timing of its discretion. That's okay. What the term. Could you check into that for me with your friends?
Okay, well, I will check into it. But the timing is one thing. The process for how that's set is another.
Well, I don't know how you're defining your terms there, but it's pretty clear that Goldman Sachs will determine when our taxpayers, when we will get our money back and what we're going to. That's a pretty serious question. Let me go to another point here. And this is who you help and who you don't help. Last year, Warren Buffett bought into Goldman Sachs at a level of $5 billion. Under your watch as Secretary of Treasury, our taxpayers were forced to invest $10 billion in Goldman, not counting the counterparty deal with AIG. Warren Buffett received 43.5 million options worth $1.8 billion for his $5 billion gamble. Okay, our taxpayers, by contrast, got 9.5 million options worth $500 million, one-fifth as much for their investment, which was double his. Buffett is being paid 10% interest on his preferred stock. Yet taxpayers only get 5% for the first 5 years and 9% for the second 5 years. Buffett has a 10% call premium. Taxpayers have no premium rights. Buffett got $5 billion of present value for his $5 billion investment. Taxpayers have $4.9 billion of present value for their $10 billion investment. How is this fair? And why did Warren Buffett get a better deal for his stockholders than you, as Secretary of Treasury, got for the American taxpayer at Goldman?
There's a very clear reason why. When we structured the capital to go into all of the banks, it was the middle of a crisis. Attractive capital was not available. The reason we had to do this is capital was not available. We wanted to do something that was available, not where we were providing it under duress, but providing capital which was structured so that the taxpayer would get paid back. The capital we put out
at the call of Goldman, whenever it sets the terms.
First of all, the banks, we put out the capital. It's preferred stock. It wasn't voting. It was 5% initially, so the taxpayer is going to get paid back all of that money, 5% interest and warrants, as various firms, and a number of firms have done well and have paid back. But we were not. You do not stop, Madam Congresswoman, you do not stop a financial panic by putting capital and offering capital to banks on the terms, the only terms that it's available in the middle of a crisis. So what we were doing was moving quickly to put capital to a range of major financial institutions that were picked because they were systemically important. And I would also argue to you that the fact that a number of those institutions have done well and
have paid back the taxpaier
is something we should all be pleased about rather than the reverse.
Well, you know, I wish you'd gotten a better deal for the taxpayers. You sure, certainly got a good deal for a lot of your former clients.
Well,
I have additional questions, Mr. Chairman.
I would say to you, I think if you look at what the taxpayer is going to make on a number of these companies, it will have been good. But the biggest advantage to the taxpayer, by far the biggest advantage to the taxpayer, is what didn't happen. And that we did not have a collapse, and we did not have a double the number of foreclosures in Ohio and double the level of
Mr. Paulson. You ought to come and visit us in Ohio and see the results of your handiwork.
Well, I know how terrible it is. I'm just telling you it would have been worse.
That's your best argument. That's not good enough.
Yeah, well, okay, gentlewoman's time has expired.
I'll persuade you because you probably don't agree there was a crisis.
Gentleman from Mr. Fortenberry.
I agree it was a crisis of your making for very.
Gentlewoman's time has expired.
Thank you.
Congressman Fortenberry from Nebraska.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hello, Mr. Secretary. Thank you for joining us today. In your testimony, you stated that you would like Congress to create a new regulatory framework to be able to intervene and facilitate the orderly wind down of a systemically important institution. What do you envision?
Well, I think something very similar to what has been suggested by the Obama administration makes sense, because there needs to be, when there is a real systemic risk, so this should not be done frivolously, when the system is at risk, there needs to be a way to avoid the normal bankruptcy process and let a regulatory body come in and handle the wind down of the liabilities in such a way as it does not prevent a real danger to the public and the financial system. And if we have a different regulatory regime and if this authority is structured properly, then we won't be in a situation where institutions are too big to fail.
Well, in that regard, what role do you foresee for the Treasury, for the Fed, for the FDIC?
Well, there have been a number of things that have been suggested. What we had suggested as part of the regulatory blueprint was the Fed playing the role of a macro stability regulator, being able to look across the whole economy and look across the capital markets for risks, being able to access and get information and having the authorities to act. In terms of the wind down, if there's a potential failure, I think there needs to be a high bar. So there would need to be a determination by the the Secretary of the Treasury, you know, by the Chairman of the Fed, by other regulators, that there is a true systemic issue. So this should not be an easy bar to get over. But when there is, then the regulator needs all of the powers to handle that wind down.
Given all of the turmoil in the economy in the last year, given the government's intervention, we're now left with the reality that 10 banks in this country control about 50% of the deposited assets. Is that a systemic risk, in your view?
It is something that makes me uncomfortable.
So how would we proceed? How would this new regulatory framework look at that potential situation?
Well, as I said, I'm just only going to deal with things that I said. I'm saying nothing now that I didn't say when I was Treasury Secretary. We put forward a regulatory blueprint which called for greater consolidation of banking regulation as opposed to the multiple regulators. And so I think having greater consolidation and stronger regulation coupled with the wind down powers so that you don't have banks or bank holding companies being too big to fail, I think is a meaningful way of dealing with the risk, because in my judgment, a regulation, no matter how good, is always going to be imperfect. And so you need to have it in balance with the market discipline or moral hazard, that we got to a point where we couldn't rely on market discipline or moral hazard because it would have taken the system down. But to the extent the infrastructure in the financial markets are fixed, and I'm talking about the tri-party repo market, credit default swaps, and there's a lot of work that's been done there, and you have the wind-down powers, and so then we're not held hostage by institutions that are too big to fail. I think there's an opportunity to get the balance right.
Just to let you know, we've changed the expression too big to fail to too big to succeed, and that's part of the intention that I have in simply asking you the question. Are we now in a place where we, because of debatable actions, and I've heard you clearly in your justifications, and I'm not trying to play gotcha here or anything, just looking ahead to say, are we now in a situation where the actions that were taken to try to stabilize the economy has left us with further vulnerability and the potential for a systemic failure because of this highly concentrated control of the financial system in the hands of a few?
I understand your question. And there's going to be, because when you look at the number of banks, there's going to be a lot more consolidation before we're done. But I do understand your question, and I think it's important we get this in balance.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
Time has expired. Congressman Clay from Missouri for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Paulson, for your candor today. Hopefully we can continue in that vein. Secretary Paulson, I have noted with great interest of your evolution from a proponent of no government interference in the free markets to a person who believes that government does and should have a role in the markets. I find that enlightening, somewhat welcoming, and also contradictory, often at the same time. However, today I have questions on why we have companies that are too big to fail. I don't believe that. Many don't believe that. Of those that you obviously think are or were too big to fail, what distinguishes them from others? Why was Lehman Brothers allowed to fail and Merrill Lynch and Bank of America were not? What were the differences in systemic risk to the country in making the decision to rescue the latter and not the former? And why rescue and assist Goldman Sachs and not Lehman Brothers?
Well, let me, you know, and I went through this earlier, and I'll go through it again. At the time when Lehman was failing, We didn't have the TARP, so we had no authority to put capital into the into Lehman Brothers, and we were unsuccessful in finding a buyer. And in the case of Bear Stearns, we had a buyer in J.P. Morgan, and the government could assist that buyer, but J.P. Morgan was providing the capital and able to guarantee the trading book.
AIG?
Let me talk about AIG, because AIG is, is another one which was different. In AIG, it was perceived as being a liquidity problem, but we had at the insurance company level, regulated insurance companies that were well capitalized, perceived as being stable. And so the Fed could solve the liquidity problem by loaning against those insurance company assets, and the market accepted that. Lehman Brothers had a capital hole and a liquidity problem, and we had been working with a group of industry participants to help finance a deal if we could get a buyer. And we were unsuccessful at getting that buyer. And so the once we had the TARP in place, we had other tools in the toolkit. And I do, there's been a lot of confusion. For instance, people will say the Fed made a loan to Lehman Brothers after they failed against that collateral. That's true. The Fed made a loan, and that was to facilitate a liquidation and a bankruptcy. A Fed loan to Lehman Brothers by itself would not have filled the capital hole, would not have taken care of the trading book guarantee, and would not have prevented a bankruptcy. So after Bear Stearns went, if you look at the record, you will look at the fact that, that Ben Bernanke and Hank Paulson each gave a number of speeches where we said, we don't have the authorities that are necessary to deal with non-banking institutions, financial institutions. So the, but your question gets asked by a lot of people because it, these were complicated issues. But yeah,
but let me look. Let me tell you what my constituents are feeling. You know, we gave AIG $180 billion on because they were irresponsible, because they took risk, because they created these exotic products and enriched themselves. They were irresponsible, and yet they get rewarded through our tax dollars. Now we own them. I mean, so when does it stop? And then what is the punishment for their irresponsibility?
Congressman, I can't tell you how much it pains me to be on the other side of this conversation, because I can't tell you how angry I was when I sat there on that weekend in September where the management team came in and laid out the issues. So this is, and you're absolutely right, the but there was a situation where we had essentially an unregulated hedge fund on top of insurance companies. There is a huge gap in our regulatory system. This should never have been allowed to happen. It did happen. All I can say to you is you will never be able to explain that so your constituents can understand it, and that's a good thing, because we don't want to have to understand this in this country. We don't want to be in a situation where this can happen again. But all I can say to you is I believe if the Fed had not have taken that action, given the size of AIG, we would have had a global banking run. We would have had a financial system meltdown. The wealth that would have been lost in 401k programs, saving plans, the wealth that would have been destroyed in this country would have been, it was tragic. So the, but now you have a situation where the government is an owner, the government is there, and we have to be careful we don't draw the line between trying to punish them and shooting ourselves and the taxpayer in the foot. Because right now, we should all want AIG to do well.
Gentleman's time has expired. Yeah.
You sure I had 5 minutes?
In fact, you had 7.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
And a sandwich.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I ask unanimous consent that Mr. Stearns and Mr. Garrett be allowed to participate, and of course, without objection, so ordered. And I now
thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Stearns.
And Mr. Paulson, I hear your pain when you said you're just pained to be on that side of the table answering the gentleman's question. But isn't it true that Goldman Sachs benefited from AIG bailout? They got $13 billion and was the largest recipient of the public funds from AIG. And in fact, creating the collateralized debt obligation, the CDOs, form the basis of the current crisis we have today. But while you were CEO of Goldman Sachs, you were an active part of that business. So my problem is when you say you're pained by AIG, I go back to your bait and switch when you came here into Congress and you suddenly decided instead of buying the toxic loans, you're going to go out and start to give money to these people. So if you didn't have any credibility on the bait and switch, how do you have any credibility today to come before us and tell us that you're pained by AIG?
Well, let me respond.
Do you understand the credibility you have? You came here, you said in this 2.5-page bill that you wanted $750 billion. Then immediately after you got approval from Congress, you changed it. You baited us on, then you switched it, and then you started giving money to these institutions, the top 15 institutions. When all these people who had the loans, you could have worked out a homeowner's equity plan around this country to help the people who are actually having their homes foreclosed. And you're helping AIG, and you're helping Bank of America, and you're bankrupting Lehman Brothers, who is your biggest competition. Isn't there some point you should have recused yourself and said, you know something, all my buddies and Goldman Sachs are over there. You know, I really feel that I shouldn't be making these decisions to make Lehman Brothers go bankrupt, that I really should recuse myself. And the fact is that you're coming here and say you feel the pain of AIG is just outrageous.
Well, I would like to respond to you, Congressman, because I find your statement outrageous. Yeah,
okay, so Mr. Paulson.
Well, let me tell you, I have the time, Mr. Paulson. Let me just say one other thing.
No, I just want you speaking to the mic. Pull the mic.
Okay.
Let me just say one other thing here. You know, when you look at, you're saying to us, you support the Obama administration giving more power to the federal regulator, the Fed. But when you look, the Fed was on, Geithner was on board at the Fed, the New York Fed, dealing with all these institutions. He didn't get it. And then we had this fellow who came up afterwards, Mr. Friedman. He was on the Goldman Sachs board. And he didn't last too long as a Fed chairman. Why? Because he had a conflict of interest. Is it possible that there's so much conflict of interest here that all you folks don't even realize that you're helping people that you're associated with and you should be recusing yourself for America's ethics?
Let me make several comments. The first comment I will say is I came to Congress, I asked for the TARP, and I asked for for authority to purchase illiquid assets.
But in 10 days, you changed your opinion.
We changed because the situation changed dramatically.
In 10 days?
You betcha. If you look at what happened in that 10-day period, you look at what happened around the world, it changed dramatically, number one. Secondly,
I don't want you to use all my time.
Okay, just secondly. I want to just respond to secondly. I left Goldman Sachs. I sold my shares in Goldman Sachs.
Tax deferred, too. You didn't have to pay any tax on your $200 million.
I sold my shares in Goldman Sachs.
There's a clause that if you come into the administration, you sell your assets, it's tax deferred. You don't have to pay $200. If you had $200 million profit, and you didn't have to pay any tax. Isn't that true?
Listen, it's
is
not
that true a, or not? Yes or
it
no?
It is. You do not pay a profit when someone a tax when someone
Maybe
makes you sell
was an
assets.
Maybe that for you become Secretary of Treasury, so you didn't have to pay the tax there.
Oh. The next thing I would say to you, and say it very, very clearly, is I behaved with the.
You don't think you should have recused yourself when you asked Lehman to go in bankruptcy? You didn't put Bear Stearns in bankruptcy, and then you folded Merrill Lynch into. I mean, isn't there some point where you got to say, "Hey, I got a conflict of interest here"? You don't feel any kind of scintilla of ethics on this thing at all?
Totally. I operated very consistently within the ethic guidelines I had as Secretary of the Treasury. And when it became when it became clear that we had some very significant issues with Goldman Sachs and with Morgan Stanley. What I did then, it would have been very wrong for me to recuse myself. What I did was I went and got a waiver from the ethics agreement, because when we had concerns.
Who was in charge of the ethics agreement?
What?
Who's in charge of the ethics agreement that you got a waiver?
We have a office of ethics at Treasury, and we have a White House ethics office.
So you got it from the legal counsel from the White House?
We got it from the government ethics office.
The gentleman's time has expired.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your courtesy. And I ask unanimous consent my opening statement to be part of the record.
Without objection, so ordered. Yep. The Congresswoman from California, Congressman Diane Watson.
Mr. Paulson, I want to thank you for being here and your patience. A few minutes ago, we talked about an institution that you thought would be able to deal with regulatory activities. How do you feel about the regulatory proposals that have been put forth by President Obama and Congress?
That's a pretty broad, general question.
Have you been following them?
I would say I made, when I was Secretary of the Treasury, I put forward a number of regulatory proposals, put forward a regulatory blueprint. And there are a number of things that the administration has put forward that I am very, very pleased about. The wind-down authorities for non-banking institutions, the idea that there be a macro stability regulator, the idea that there be a consolidation of banking regulators. So I think there's some very positive ideas that have been put forward.
Would you please, if we send you the exact questions, would you put your responses in writing so I can say that when we form this new regulatory system, these are some of the points that we ought to consider. We're trying to unscramble eggs that are really rotten at this point. And we must move forward and correct this system. It's impacting on not only the United States, but the rest of the world, too. We got to get it right. And I cannot be convinced that this wasn't seen back a year ago, the collapse. But in trying to move on, I want to reiterate what has happened on Tuesday. It was reported that just 1 month after repaying their $10 billion in aid, Goldman Sachs would be posting a second quarter net profit of $3.44 billion. I'm curious to hear your perspective on their success despite the recession, given your 26 years of experience at Goldman Sachs and the unique role former Goldman employees have played in economic policy, considering that the last two chairmen of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, the head of the World Bank, and the head of the New York Stock Exchange, and the former assistant secretary at Treasury responsible for TARP, Neil Kaskari, were all former Goldman Sachs employees. And why do you believe Goldman Sachs has been able to bring in such profits despite the current economic conditions?
Yeah, I don't have an answer for you. I have not worked at Goldman Sachs in 3 years, so I can't explain what they're doing that's working. But I can say I take some comfort, and I think all of you should, that there are a number of financial institutions that are more profitable today, and it looks increasingly like the government will be paid back with profits on a number of these plans. And in terms of your request to me to give you something in writing, I'll work with you on that. I don't have a staff like I used to, and I have a lot of requests.
No, you can handwrite them. I do have a staff. And we'll send you in writing what we would like to ask and what you think should be proposed. You can write it in hand. You can do pencil to paper. We'll be.
Well, I'll do my best to work with you on it. Thank you.
All right. I appreciate that. And do you think that Goldman Sachs has benefited from the economic crisis and the dissolution of some of their strongest competitors, such as Lehman Brothers?
I don't know what is the source of the profits, and I've got no basis to speculate on it.
Okay. How was the determination made that institutions such as Bear Stearns, AIG, and Merrill Lynch should be saved either through direct assistance or acquisition, while Lehman Brothers would be allowed to fail? I'm not quite clear, and I know you've addressed it.
Yeah, I did, and I can. I will just say to you, we did not have the legal powers, we believe, to do something in the Lehman Brothers case. We did not have the TARP to put capital in, and we did not have a buyer as we did in the case of Bear Stearns. And so we were faced with sort of an unfortunate set of circumstances.
And I will conclude. I see the red light, Mr. Chairman, but I just want to say if we have missed our oversight responsibilities, I need to know what you consider in writing, and we'll put that in our letter to you, what you consider government could do more of. I do know that we did not, this committee under the former administration did not do the kind of oversight. Maybe we were asleep at the wheel, or maybe we looked the other way. But I'd like to hear from you what government could do so we don't get in this situation again. And I think really it's worse than the Depression of the 30s. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for
Thank
the extra seconds.
Thank the gentleman from California. I now yield to Mr. Garrett of New Jersey.
And I thank the chairman. Thank you, Secretary.
Good to see you.
Before I begin, just make a comment on one of your comments when I was walking in the room. You, with regard to AIG, saying that there was a gap in with regard to coverage, not coverage, but gap with regard to authority and regulation there. We've had a number of panels in financial services look at this, and the bottom line is that the takeaway that I've always heard is it's not a gap in authority, not a gap in regulation, that there were regulators there in place. But what they actually admitted to was they had the authority, they had the personnel, but you know what? They just missed it. They weren't looking in the right places, and it was just an error on the part of personnel.
And it may have been a gap in terms of capability when you look at the multiple regulators.
That's probably a good way to phrase it. One of the things that you have said, and others, since Secretary Bernanke as well, said, is that what we needed here was resolution authority. And that's what we need to answer her question going forward, is resolution authority as well. But here's a question I'll pose for you hypothetically. Had we had resolution authority prior to the AIG situation, can you think and explain to me how it would be different? And I'll just posit two thoughts to you. If you had the resolution authority and they tried to move in and to try to wind down the firm in a more quicker manner, well, we know right now there is no real market out right there, and that would, the same reason we're not doing it right now, is put a more larger burden on the taxpayer, right? And if you did it, what they're doing now essentially is saying we're going to do it out over a period of time, there's still the threat of the problem over it. So help me understand why anything would be different significantly to the taxpayer and to the structure had we had a wind down authority in place prior to the AIG situation.
With AIG, it was necessary to keep the current. The company didn't go through bankruptcy.
Right.
Kept the current corporate structure.
Right.
Worked within the legal framework.
Right.
The one thing that is similar is that the Fed made a loan which is going to be repaid as pieces of the company are sold. But since I don't know, you know, in terms of AIG,
yeah,
my role was in giving the Fed support as they made this decision. But once the action was taken, I had no dealings. So I just don't know the details And I think probably the Fed would be better to answer that question for you in terms of what they're doing now and what they might do differently with the resolution authority.
Okay. I only posit the question because I do know you were not on the scene after the fact, but I just posit the question because I know you have said in the past and here, too, I think that we need the wind-down authority. But I'm not really seeing, and that's, I haven't got my hands around from other witnesses as well, what would have been different in that situation. And now we have the situation, as you well know, with the CIT. Looking like that they are not going to be able to get a bailout, if you will. And so we're haven't we already set up the precipice, set up the situation, maybe going all the way back with Bear Stearns, that you create the conundrum of them saying that we look to the government to bail out, and under the administration proposals they say we're only going to bail out the Tier 1 entities, and CIT apparently just doesn't fall into that category, so they're not going to get the bailout. So you have a disincentive now, you have a or a disservice to the taxpayer and disincentive to the taxpayer that you're going to encourage companies like that in the future. Say, boy, I better get into that Tier 1 situation again or else I'm going to fall into the CIT situation. Isn't that the problem with the administration's proposal?
Well, I don't have all of the facts in terms of what has happened. When I was here, the regulators made CIT a bank holding company. They came in with a regulatory recommendation to Treasury. We funded them out of TARP. I have lost touch. I don't know what's happened, but I understand the issue, the conundrum you've laid out, and that is why really the only answer is we need to exit from all of these programs as soon as we can.
Yeah, but my fear is that we. And my question to you would be, would we not, under the administration's proposal, and I know you spend some time looking at these things, basically perpetuating that situation going forward? In other words, if we set the administration's plan into place and we begin to identify certain entities as being too big to fail, the Tier 1 institutions, then the CITs of the world, and I know you may not be up to speed on, neither am I, on the particulars right there. But the CITs of the world will say, we want to get into that situation in the future. And that's the basic underlying flaw in the administration's proposal, that you perpetuate the problem. Would you agree with that?
I do agree that one thing, that we don't want to move toward a situation in this country where we have certain organizations that are too big to fail and everyone else can fail. And we want to get to a situation where no one is too big to fail. Now, I don't know enough about the CIT to jump to the same conclusion you are about that, but I understand the dilemma you're pointing to.
Yeah. Gentlemen's time has expired. Okay. I indicated to Mr. Paulson that we would get him out. He has a plane to catch, so I'd like to now yield a closing statement to the ranking member. Mr. Issa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for this hearing, and I look forward to the reform part of our oversight and reform. And at this time, I'd like to ask unanimous consent that the committee consolidate questions of the minority and majority so that we can keep from overburdening Mr. Paulson and still work with him to get follow-up answers.
Without objection, so ordered.
Thank you. Mr. Paulson, I personally want to thank you as a private citizen for coming here and giving us so much of your time and your insight into what happened at this very difficult time. There are unanswered questions. There are questions that we will never know. We will never know, had Merrill Lynch stayed on its own, stood on its own, and received, let's say, half of the TARP money that the combined company received, would it in fact today be a viable going concern? Would the backup plans envisioned by the Treasury and the Fed, in case B of A were to back out, would they in fact have worked? We'll never know that. Mr. Secretary, I want to thank you for your attempts to make sure we never had to know it. I, in fact, have been an outspoken critic of some of the activities, including the threats. I am and will continue to be an outspoken critic of expanding the Fed's role beyond the monetary supply and giving them a direct role in the systemic risk question. I do so because I believe that the Fed has a primary and premier obligation as an economic modeling organization. While you have a long history in mergers and acquisitions, understanding of what a, quote, good merger is and a bad merger is, that's not inherently a core talent that we expect to see in the Fed. So as we work to go forward to find the right models in case something like this happens again, and hopefully the right models to see it before it happens and prevent it. I hope you'll continue to be a resource for us, because I do believe that the Commission, which has just been formed, and this committee have an obligation to make sure we get it right so we don't have to do it again. Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you for this series and for your continued partnership on a bipartisan basis, and particularly for your help today in making sure that everyone got their questions in, including those who have not yet asked them. And with that, I close and yield back and thank the Chairman.
Thank you very much for your statement. Let me just say, Mr. Paulson, again, thank you for coming, you know, but still, there's some unanswered questions, you know, I would hope that maybe you could give it to us in writing, that, you know, when they looked at the books at Merrill Lynch, they realized there was a $9 billion shortfall. This is according to Mr. Lewis. And then, of course, this discovered further that maybe it was a $12 billion shortfall. But my question to you, and hope that you give it back to us in writing, because when I asked you earlier today, you didn't respond to it. How did it get from $12 billion to $20 billion? There's no real answer.
I can tell you. That's one I can tell you. I can't give it to you in writing because I don't know. That what I heard was a call on the 17th. Where the losses were $18 billion pre-tax. By the 19th, there are $22 billion pre-tax. And when I said to people, that's a loss that takes my breath away, when the market hears that. Now, all I could say to you is December, the end of November and December were the worst months in the marketplace. And banks, it was the worst month for the economy. If you look at what's going on economically, it was the worst month in terms of the credit products and banks' losses. And so I didn't, when I looked at it, I wasn't shocked that this could have happened so quickly. But I don't have that explanation. You would have to get that from Merrill Lynch or B of A.
Yeah, you know, I could see this if we're talking about millions, but yeah. We're talking about billions, like B and boy.
Yeah. That was my reaction. I saw and witnessed things that I never had seen before, and so what was going on in the marketplace at that point in time, what B of A and Merrill subsequently explained to me was the products they had in inventory, the credit products. There was a big erosion in value based upon what was going on in the markets, but I don't know. It was I heard about it for the first time on the 17th.
Right. Let me just finish by saying, last year at the height of the financial crisis, major decisions were made about who was going to live and who was going to die. Lehman went down, but AIG was saved. Bear Stearns was sold off. Bank of America received billions. Nine big banks were forced to take billions. In many instances, they didn't even ask for. Most significantly, all of this was decided behind closed doors with no oversight. In a way, the Bank of America, Merrill Lynch deal illustrates the dangers of concentrating enormous power in only one or two individuals. When you turn over complete authority to the Treasury Department or the Feds, with no accountability and no checks and balances, this is what you get. Oral commitments involving billions of dollars, seemingly arbitrary decision making, and residual suspicion. Mr. Paulson has stated that the principal regulatory agencies, the SEC and the FDIC, were consulted in this merger. I think it is clear that we need to hear next from the former SEC Chairman, Mr. Cox, and from FDIC Chairperson Bear, to better understand the nature and extent of their participation. I intend to schedule a hearing for the purpose following the August recess. There are some unanswered questions here. And if we're going to reform our financial system, I think we need to have the answers to these questions. So, Mr. Paulson, I want to thank you for taking the time and come, and I hope that you will become a resource in many, many ways to be able to help us to sort of unfold and get through this mess and to be able to come back stronger than ever before. Thank you so much for testifying.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
C-SPAN today, Defense Secretary Robert